for your righteousness, peace. Can everybody hear me out there? Can everybody hear me? Let me know. Okay. Peace, everybody. And I hope everybody's in excellent health, the best can be, in captivity, wherever you are. Even those of us who might be in the land listening, you in captivity too, because you're in the hand of Esau, you know, like I mentioned in this session. And you know, we've talked about it before. Yeshaya chapter 42, you know, Yah's given the land, Israel, into the hand of the robbers, the descendants of Esau. So, you know, that's where we are, and we've got to turn to Yah with all our heart and soul in order to, you know, to get to the land and establish Yah and bring it into this curse and this double curse on the descendants of Jerusalem, and the curse on Israel, and the curse on the earth and the people of the earth. You know, we've got to totally commit and submit and obey this law now. As always, this is for Yah, righteousness, Jerusalem, and the Holy Seed. And I know all of you who've been in the room today, who, you know, been listening, you possibly heard how Esau was attacking the session, even though it was pre-recorded, as we've been doing now for over a year and a half. Well, let's see. Not over a year and a half, but over a year now. So he was attacking it. So evidently they've got the computers all bugged up, and you know, they're probably listening when we actually record the session. They're probably listening then, you know, because when I first mentioned about how Yah said to Samuel, "Why are you still grieving?" You know, about Saul, seeing as how Saul had messed up and Yah had rejected him. They messed with that initially, but I came back later and I said it again, and I noticed they didn't get it messed up then. Hopefully when Yeshaya puts it up on the site, it'll come up pristine. And as always, I know Yadita's going to play it however many times in the future, you know, next week, week after, possibly, whatever. So all of you can go back and listen to it again, because they attacked some other parts as well. Key areas, you know, when I was talking about the reading the article about the young Gentile girl who was going to college and how she lived about 3 miles away, you know, in Philadelphia. She lived in the affluent area, and about 3 miles away, you know, was the area where we lived in and where we live in Philly, and how the area is all depressed. And you got these areas like this, you know, this situation in many of the cities, because we got this here in Chicago. It's very similar. We've got areas where Gentiles and Edomites live that are very nice and pristine, generally basically no problems, you know, but here we are here in Auburn Gresham. We live about 3 miles, if that, from an area called Beverly Hills, and it's basically no problems in Beverly Hills, but where we live, Auburn Gresham, is problems all the time, okay, because it's basically Israel. Now, you've got some Israelites that live in this area of Beverly Hills, and now you probably got some that live in that area that the Gentile was talking about. She was raised up in Philly. But for the most part, the children of Israel were under the curse. And again, if you're descending out of Jerusalem, you're under the double curse. So we're catching it, definitely, those of us who have not awakened to the fact that we Israel and turned to the Most High. That's the only way that curse is going to start to be relieved, is when we turn to the Most High and embrace all of this law with all our heart and soul. Again, Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 2. Now, it's just a few articles, you know, there's no need for me to keep to the next session, so I'm going to go through them pretty quick. And then a couple other things I want to talk about now. Again, Democracy Now. I don't know if I mentioned it on this session, but July 2nd, watch that session on Democracy Now, and July 8th, definitely make sure you watch that one too. Okay, because the one on the 2nd is they got a segment on there talking about the situation in the land with our brothers and sisters, the so-called Palestinians. But the one on the 8th, they even got it's much more profound, where they've got Ali Abu Nima. He's on there for maybe about 10 minutes. But they also got this Edomite whose father was a general. The way it sounds, like he's passed now, his father, but his father was a general in the Edomite army going all the way back to the Six-Day War, you know, back in 1967. And this general's son, who used to be in, from what I understood, he used to be in the army too, but he's left, and he's, you know, talking about how the Israelis, as he calls them, but, you know, the descendants of Esau, how they have attacked our brothers and sisters, the so-called Palestinians, all the way back, since 1948. And Yahushua, I know you watch it. You know we talked about it. But you need to watch that, because he's running it down, okay? He's making it very apparent just what's been going on over there with the Edomites. Now, again, you know, when you listen to these different Edomites who are taking up a stance for us, you know, our brothers and sisters, so-called Palestinians, or us in whatever shape, form, or fashion, you got to remember and understand they might be telling a lot of truth, but unless they actually say that they are a descendant of Esau and they're not Israel, they're still suspect too, okay? You know, the Finkelsteins, like I said, this Edomite on Democracy Now on the 8th of this month, the Max Blumenthal's, the Josh Rubner's, if they don't acknowledge that they're a descendant of Esau and that they're not Israel, they're still suspect, okay? But you know, still, again, as I said on the last session, the Illuminati Edomite is behind a lot of this push for the peace and push for the BDS, boycott, divestment, sanctions, because he's trying to push the Edomites in the land to make peace, and they're not going to do it. They're never going to do it, okay? And again, just since I'm talking about the subject, you know, we heard it the other day that those three kidnapped and come up dead. We heard they were in the army. They were in the Edomite army over there, okay? But still, there's no proof just who kidnapped them and how they come up dead, see? And, it's so one-sided in the information and the news coverage that you get, basically, whether it's the printed news or the news that comes across the airwaves, is generally always one-sided. You got to go to places like Democracy Now! And even then, it's you know, a little still tainted to a degree. You got to go to places like RT, Press TV, possibly Al Jazeera, and maybe the BBC possibly might have a little bit better. But, you know, the average news source here in America is going to be tainted and one-sided, generally. Okay, now, here's this article in Chicago Sun-Times, July 7th, again. They had arrested six Edomite suspects, arresting and burning a Palestinian boy. You know it doesn't say Edomite. I'm saying that, right? Call it like it is, right? You understand, one of our Palestinian brothers over there in the land asked Netanyahu in regards to the Palestinian brother who was beaten and on TV, and I know many of you probably seen that. They had it up on TV, on RT, and they probably had it on internet. But in regards to these six suspects who were arrested for burning the brother, you know, this old Palestinian brother, he was on there. He was like, up their homes like you blow up our homes. When one of us, you know, supposedly has done something, you come and blow up his family's home and whatnot. Everybody connected. He wanted to know, you know, was it going to be a balanced situation? Are you going to blow up their homes, you know? And you know what the answer to that is. And it never was an answer, but you know what the answer was. also in regards to that 4th of July, right, it never fails. Every 4th of July is always you hear about or read about somebody who lost a limb or lost their eyesight, you know, got blown up some kind of way. And here, in out of San Jose, California, fireworks claimed both hands, a man igniting illegal fireworks blew off both of his hands in front of relatives when a device exploded prematurely. He was in his 40s. He's expected to live, but he's going to be handless. Okay? Now, that's what happens when you fool around, you know, doing something that you have no business doing. Also out of Chicago, Sun-Times, July 8th, they had wildfire burning in high heat in Winters, California. More than 1,600 firefighters battling a wildfire Monday in a rug patch of far northern California faced another day of triple-digit temperatures and gutsy winds as officials warned the flames could again threaten homes. Such dry conditions have hurt the fight against other wildfires in Idaho, New Mexico, Utah, and Washington State. Okay? Again, you know, Yah is bringing forth judgment on the daughter of Babylon, right? United States of America. This is out of Accra, Ghana. U.S. citizen tested for Ebola. Okay? Health officials in Ghana say a U.S. citizen is being tested for Ebola and remains in quarantine after he fell ill while in Western Africa. Ebola causes severe internal bleeding and sometimes causes its victims to bleed from the nose and ears. There is no specific treatment for the disease. Now, again, I got I've read articles just here in this session about this Ebola virus and how it's spread rapidly in the continent, you know, over there in what they call it Africa. And like I said, I don't know if they're helping it along, right? Which possibly is the case, because they, you know, a lot of the people in these different African countries won't allow themselves to be vaccinated because they understand what's going on. You know, with the WHO, the World Health Organization, you don't even hear anything anymore about the Red Cross. But, you know, they were over there for years inoculating people, vaccinating people. You don't even hear about the Red Cross. And, you know, some years back, I talked about the Red Cross again, Red Cross, right? You know, and the Red Cross is what the Knights Templar was the emblem on, the white shields that they carried and the white tunics, okay? Okay, so the Red Cross, you understand, you know, and I've said this before, when the Knights Templars had to go underground when they were attacked by the Pope back there in 1306 CEAD, they popped up about 140 years later, not quite 140 years later, in the 15th century CEAD, around 1442, they popped up as the Rosicrucians, okay? And when you look up Rosicrucian, it means rosy cross or red cross, okay? So that's them again. Maya Amschild Bauer, who renamed himself, surnamed himself Child. Goldsmith shots back there in the 18th century, and he hung a red shield over the door. Of his red shield is just one of those shields that, I would have said, to hide the red cross or the rosy cross. Yeah, well, I know they're going to mess with that, okay? You know they're going to mess with that. There you go. Okay. Hold on. Yeah, since they mess with it, huh? What part do you know they came in on? Knights Templar. Yeah, I got you. Okay. Okay. All right, got you. God bless. Yeah, I knew they was gonna mess with that. It's clear. Say it's clear there, but they chopping that up, right? Yeah, but old man Bauer, Maya Amschel Bauer, turned his name to Maya Amschel Rothschild. Rothschild means red shield, and that's what he hung up over the goldsmith shop or the pawn shop back there. Red shield, huh? And that's how you can identify, okay, these people and take it back. Yeah, I imagine of all its staffers, about 43,000 worldwide. UN Secretary of State took the mic. Gee. They took the mic, huh? Okay. Okay, I got it. All right, y'all good. Yeah, he saw that work. Because like I said, they were attacking the session. I know plenty of you. Wrecking the first, they never actually recognized gay marriage, but now they are. So he isn't letting up, huh? I hear you. Well, what can you do? He's at work. He's upset. So you can hear me now, huh? He's upset. But, you know, we'll come back. But also out of Chicago Tribune, July 7th, six arrested in Palestinians death. Israeli officials decry killing of Jerusalem teen. You know, they gotta make a show, right? But I just marked a couple of things. It says, speaking to reporters outside the courthouse, so Muhammad Abu Qatar demanded that the killers' homes be demolished. You hear? That's what I just got through talking about, right? He said a common Israeli punishment for the families of Palestinian militants. During the speech last week, deaths of three we don't know. Something they told me. Okay? Okay, you can find Google, my chair, right chair, for more information on the topic. Yeah, I don't know what they're going to have on the Google, but Google it anyway and see. All right? And so the brother, Hussein Abu Qatar, he is asking Bibi Netanyahu to do what he did in Hebron, okay? Blow up these suspects. Also, Chicago Tribune, July 7th. You know, they got a thing over there in England, right? British Prime Minister David Cameron is facing calls to launch a full-scale inquiry into allegations that politicians abused children in the 1980s after an official said the government lost files related to the matter. The allegations made headlines after an opposition lawmaker raised them in parliament. Okay? You know, we've talked about this in the past, how these elite over there in Britain been abusing and, you know, these children over there for years. It's been going on a long time. You know, if I can't remember when I talked about it, possibly last year, I think it was possibly, and I touched on the article. It was some article about how they had an island. Oh, it's an island over there in the
English Channel.
The English Channel. I know Yada said his name, Jersey or something like that, but they got a place over there where the elite, I know they're going to mess with that too, Malcolm, Yadida. I know they're going to mess with that. But they've been abusing these children on this island for years, you know, committing all kind of heinous acts. Jersey Island, right, Yadida, that's it, Jersey Island. And they've been committing heinous acts on these children for years, pedophilia and everything else. And it's all coming out because everything's got to come out now. Okay? So that's the investigation, you know, that's urged. All right? And it's come up in Parliament over there. Like I said, they say it's been going on since the 1980s, but it's probably been going on since 1680. You understand what I mean? Another hope to hold first meeting with sex abuse victims. Okay, so he's gonna meet, this Pope gonna meet with some of the victims of the sex abuse that been perpetrated by these priests in Catholicism. Okay, and here's another article about the Edomites. You know, this is Chicago Tribune, July 8th. The Edomites, they got a picture here, you know, how they're bombing Gaza, right? You see the smoke coming up, okay? And they're bombing Gaza, you know, horribly killing up people, as many of you probably saw up on the screen. Somebody put up on the screen a little earlier, 180 some people killed, 100 some people wounded. And they still, it still hasn't, I don't know if they actually gone in on Gaza yet, but that's still to be determined, and it's possibly they going to do that. Yeah, I know they messing with that too, you did. But again, they bombing Gaza relentlessly because, you know, it's no proof, again, how these teenagers come up missing who were in the army. Like I said, nobody's actually come out with that. You know, definitely not on American TV. Here's another article, Chicago Tribune, July 8th. You know, I know many of you heard about the spy situation over there in Germany, how they kicked out CIA guy from the United States. They done caught him spying two different times, but they told him he got to go. And there's been a big uproar about that. The German officials is totally upset. Okay, about this spying that America's been doing on them. Okay, and again, this is, we heard the other day, this is driving Germany, you know, who's already have a strong rapport with Russia, is driving Germany even more so up into the arms of Russia. Okay, then many of you probably heard about the earthquake that hit Mexico and Guatemala, you know, at this. The writing of this, it was 3 dead so far, and it was of 6.9 magnitude. And then, you know, again, another little article about the sex abuse that is rattling the British political elite, okay? And how the British pledged, you know, to investigate these claims that politicians may have sexually abused children in the 80s in a conspiracy by members of the establishment who used their power to cover up the crimes. Okay, and they say the allegations have jarred the current political elite. Okay? Here's another article out of Chicago Tribune, July 8th. And many of you probably heard this because a brother on the West Coast called me and we were talking and he mentioned this. He's like, Yoda, you know, over the 4th of July weekend here in Chicago, they had 82 shootings in 84 hours. Okay? And they got a big article here calling replicating an urban war zone is the wrong way to be a global city. Talking about Chicago and all this proliferation of shootings and killings. But again, when this came out, this was Wednesday of this week. I was cutting the line. And so one of my neighbors that, you know, we've had some conversations in the past, he lives about a block away around the corner. And I hadn't seen him in a while. I must have thought him up. And he had come across my mind a couple of days, two, three, 4 days prior that I hadn't seen him. And then I looked up and he was coming towards me. And so I turned off the lawnmower and we talked for a minute, not real long, but he had been in Phoenix. He's got a place in Phoenix. So he said him and his wife had been there and they were talking about, he was talking about how hot it was there. But he was saying to me how while they were there, you know, like five police in Phoenix had gotten shot. Okay. And he said, they talk about all of the shootings here in Chicago. He said, but this stuff is happening there. He said five police got shot in Phoenix, Arizona. Now I hadn't heard anything about that. Okay. So, you know, as I was telling somebody later, because I didn't have a long conversation with him, but I did say to him, though, they got a reason why they broadcast the shootings and whatnot here like they do. And it's my mind that they're doing it like this because they've got a plan that they're going to attack us, Israel, here in Chicago. I mean, we're under attack, don't get me wrong, but they got another plan for what I see in store. How they gonna hit a lot of our youth? They already hit them, because with the closing down of 52 schools last year, they hit them. They hit us, but you know, definitely those of us who have children in the Chicago public school system. And I know all of you have been listening today. You heard what I just said in this past session about the deplorable situation that the school children, you know, Israelite, so-called African-American school children are in here in Chicago. And it's not only, you know, the so-called African-American ones of us, but many of our Latino Israelites, are in that same kind of condition. But the point being they're publicizing this because they got something up their sleeve. You know, they got something planned, you know, because it kind of came out last year with this Senator Mark Kirk of Illinois came out where he wants to arrest all of these gang members, something like 18,000, okay, of gang members. And so they're putting this signal out, right? And again, you know, where he said something like 18,000, well, you know, they can always put out the bigger number like they did with the schools. Talking about, you know, Rahm Emanuel said they're going to close down 125 schools or something like that. It started out. But as we said in one of the sessions here last year, the president of the teachers union said it was always going to be 50. Okay? They knew that. They just blew it out to 125. So when they closed to 50, people would take that, you know, as a victory. So I look at Mark Kirk saying that they're going to arrest 18,000, you know, they need to incarcerate 18,000 gang members here in Chicago. Well, quite naturally, they put out the huge come and arrest effort. Understand? Maybe. It was the ones that happened on them. You follow what I'm saying? Because they got files on all of them. Yeah, right. I figured they're going to chop that up, Yudita, because that's what the deal is. Okay? That's what the deal is. And they don't want the people to understand this and to hear this. We got it told about the about the shooting is being done by the police. Okay, but again, those of you can hear this, can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Let me know if you probably can't even hear me. Okay, you can hear me now. But again, the police here in Chicago are doing some of these shootings. This is not all gang, so-called gang members of these shootings that's going on. And they got it in their mind where they're going to come and attack a lot of these Israelite brothers. You understand? That's gang affiliated. Okay? Simply because guilt by association. And they're going to come and they got something planned where they're going to lock them up. And see, that's why they're doing all this publicity about these shootings. So when they do it, it won't be any real big outcry. Okay? Many of the people say, yeah, well, they had to get rid of them because it's horrible. They had to do something. You follow me? They got something planned. You know, just like they sterilizing. It's come out, they sterilizing a lot of these Israelites and men, you know, that's being locked up. And I know it's happening to many Israelites, okay? But possibly immigrants as well. Okay, they're sterilizing them when they get come up into the prison system, you know, through vaccination shots or what have you, food. It's probably an all-out attack. They're hitting them any and every kind of way, right? So you can look forward to that. With, you know, and it's possibly this attack on arresting many of these so-called gang members or gang members, whether they did something or not. That possibly will happen in the very near future, okay? That's why they're publicizing these shootings like they are. Like I said, all these shootings, I don't believe it's all us that's doing them, okay? I don't believe that. Some of these shootings are contrived, because just like here where we are, this shooting sometimes around here, the police be on the scene in like 1 minute and a half. The police come on the scene quicker than I can go to the window to take a look. Now, okay? See, so all of this is not, you know, actually being perpetrated by the people. It's being perpetrated by the powers that be. Also out of July 8th, Chicago Tribune. You heard me mention that on this session, right, about ADM Archer Daniel Midland buying up, Wild Flavors out of Germany for over $3 billion, okay? Over $3 billion they paid to purchase this company. And from what I read, you know, it was like, their competition offered, I think, around $2 billion, okay? And they just went a whole billion more over that, you know, a little over a billion over what the nearest competitor offered. That's how bad they wanted it, and they got it, okay? And so, like I said on this session, you can look for anything that's coming out of Wild Flavors and whatever they're going to call it, because they're probably going to change the name, right? So you won't be able to recognize it right off. And it's going to be coming out of Germany, and they're going to be hitting the people in Europe. But you can just about bet on the attack through seasonings and different flavorings that's coming produced by this Wild Flavor. They're going to do some kind of GMO stuff in it. You know what I'm saying? Canola or soy, something. You can look for that. That's going to happen. Also, Chicago Tribune, July 8th. You know, they got talking about drone use moves closer to reality. You know, they're going to start using drones here in America. They probably already use them, okay? But they're telling you this is real close to being a reality where they're going to be flying drones around these cities and whatnot, spying on people, okay? And you know, watching people. You're not even going to be knowing that you watched, right? And said, amid clamor about safety, privacy, FAA says regulations are being drafted. You hear that? Regulations are being drafted to be put into law where they can fly these drones and they'll be able to, you know, when they spot somebody doing something, you think you've done something nobody knows about, right? No matter what it might be. And they pop up at your house with a warrant for your arrest. And you like, you know, where this coming from? You know, it might be 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 days, a month later. You know, like them red light tickets that you get from the red light cameras, right? Or speeding tickets you get from the speeding camera. And, you know, the thing will come through the mail after about a month or so. And you like, what is this, right? And then they got you on the screen, you know, making an illegal right-hand turn. Sometimes you be making a legal one. They instant got you because, you know, these are machines. They malfunction, okay? So you can look for this to start happening in the near future where they'll pick up something on the drone. When it gets turned in, it might take 2, 3 weeks, like I say, a month, and they'll pop up at your door with a summons or, you know, a subpoena or something. You understand what I'm saying? That's where it's all headed. Okay? And Chicago Sun-Times, July 9th. You know, the Edomite military masses troops along the Gaza border, because like I said earlier, they're getting ready to go in on them, more likely than not, because they want to get rid of them, you know. Many of you probably heard about the typhoon in Tokyo, right? Stops transports. The typhoon paralyzed transportation and knocked out power to thousands on the southern Japanese islands of Okinawa, one of the strongest and biggest typhoons to hit during Japan's summer. Typhoon Noguri was packing sustained winds of 100 miles per hour and gusts up to 134 miles per hour, okay? Also, Ford recalled over 101,000 cars, or should I say cars and SUVs. So that's more of the sword, you know, on the chariots, right? You remember chapter 50, what's that, verse 37? July 9th, Chicago Tribune, the Edomites escalate strikes on Gaza, right? Palestinians say 23 killed. That's then. It's a lot more now, right? Say rockets rain upon Edomite town. That's what they claim. You know, the Palestinians virtually shooting like firecrackers. You know, because, you know, like I said, when you watch that July 8th Democracy Now, you're going to hear that Edomite, the son of the general, you listen to it, he's going to run it down how, hey, he said, all you can do is expect the Palestinians to do something. He said, you keep bombing them and cut off water from them. You attack them in any and every kind of way. He said, you keep doing people like that, you can expect some kind of retaliation, right? I mean, any of you out there, if somebody kept poking you in your side and you kept telling them to stop and they kept on doing it, eventually what you gonna do? You follow what I'm saying? They keep on poking you and you try to move away and they move right with you and keep on poking you and you done told them to stop 5 or 6 times, what eventually you gonna do? Huh? You gonna retaliate. That's like almost like a knee-jerk reaction, right? See, and also here in this article, in another article, it says U.S. ties to China growing strained, okay? American allies' disputes hinder global debates. And, you know, America's relations is getting strained with all these big nations, and a lot of little ones is already strained, right? And I was in the store yesterday, and... I mean, it was an entourage of Chinese that came in there. I mean, it was like almost more Chinese that was coming up in there than Gentiles and Edomites. I mean, they was all up through that, okay? Because they got that money, okay? You understand? They got the money. See? Now, Chicago Tribune, July 9th. You just heard me talk about the situation in North Carolina, right? And how the water's rising. I wish I could show you this picture. They got a picture. See, I didn't have a picture, I don't think, in the session that I just read, right, about the article about the water rising in North Carolina. But they got a picture here that shows you these big, huge homes down there on the ocean front, right? And the water is like right in their front yard. All right? And they got these homes up on stilts, like, okay? I mean, they got them hyped all up, okay? And you know, I'm pretty sure I said on the session, right, because I was on the phone part of the session, but I'm pretty sure I said on the session, the article I read about this, that the guy said, you know, they had hyped up, he got some federal funds, him and his wife, to hype their home up in the air. Still, the garage is flooded with water from the his home looked down a lot of times, the water is like right up under his house. Okay? So they got to come out in hip boots. You understand what I mean? And, I mean, it's something. So, you know, what does it say? Banking on time to fend off sea. You hear me? That's the title of this section here. Banking on time to fend off sea. Coastal leaders struggle to grasp forecast and what to do about it. Because there ain't nothing to do about it. And again, I bring this up. I'm pretty sure I said it on the session, right? Again, what does it say over there in 51, Yeshaya? When y'all got through talking to Yeremia, who was locked up in the prison house, and he was giving the word of Yah to Sariah, and Sariah was writing it down. Right? And what did he say to Sariah? When you get through reading, you know, this is what Yah said through Yeremia. When you get through reading all this prophecy on the daughter of Babylon, you know, the United States of America today, right? Tie a stone to it and throw it off into the Euphrates, right? Because, you understand, I think it was the Euphrates or some river, right? Said, because, you understand, when this happens, you understand, Babylon going to sink just like this stone hooked up to this word going to sink in the water. Babylon is going to sink. Now, I ask you, when you take this into account, they tell you the water's rising. So does that mean that Babylon is sinking? That's like the cup is half full or half empty, right? It all depends on how you want to look at it. But it's still, right? It's going underwater. Okay? Now, prophecy fulfilled. Now, see, for all these people who wants to say, you know, that this book is a funny book, or you know what I mean, you're not reading the book. Chicago Sun-Times, July 10th. Now, just like they got a recall on cars and the SUVs, here's the recall on Harley Davidson motorcycles. Motorcycles recall because wheels might lock up.
Oh, okay.
So they didn't recall over 66,000 Harley Davidsons. So it's chariots, whether it's two-wheel chariots or four-wheel chariots, right? And again, here's another thing. UN chief urges restraint. You know, Ban Ki-moon is urging the Edomites to restrain from attacking Gaza, right? And here's another one out of New Orleans. I know many of you, not all of you, heard about the ex-mayor, former mayor Ray Nagin, right? They give him 10 years in prison, okay? He was convicted on, a lot of counts. It wasn't all of them. I think they let him go on two, but he was convicted on a whole lot of counts for fraud, money laundering, and all this type of thing. And he's 58 years old, plus they want him to pay back a little over $500,000, right? And they gave him 10 years in prison. So, you know, for all you out there aspiring to be a mayor of a city or a town, I think you better think about that, huh? You got any relatives that's thinking about running for office, you tell them they better think about it, okay? Because Ray Nagin said that, you know, they owned him for comments he made during Katrina, okay? about Chocolate City and how the government doesn't care about, you know, us in these cities, right? So, but they saying it was a pile of evidence against him. So, you know, you decide, right? But nevertheless, he got 10 years in prison. And he, like I said, he owes them over $500,000. He got to repay. So he's going to end up broke. And with a federal case, you got to do like 80% of the time. So he got to do at least 8 years. Okay? Here's another article. Rapes not investigated at 2 in 5 colleges. This is out of Washington, you know. Reported on these college campuses. They're saying it's only 2 out of 5 that's actually investigated. You know, because these colleges pull in a lot of money. You know, so they want to keep them scandals down, right? This is out of Chicago Tribune, July 10th, right? They got a report in here, you know, Edward Snowden, now he NSA, FBI spied on U.S. Muslims. Snowden disclosure allegedly reveals email monitoring. Okay, so allegedly, but you know, that's what they was doing, and probably a lot more, right? Also, it says Chicago's, this is an article about Chicago, Chicago's life expectancy up, but neighborhood matters. High homicide infant death rates in some areas leave major disparities, and you know where those areas are. Of high infant mortality and homicide and you know, high homicide death rates is in our communities. Okay. And here's an article out of Chicago Tribune, July 10th. Again, you know, Germany finds another U.S. secret agent suspect, another one, right? And they said German politicians reacted angrily Wednesday to news of suspected U.S. spy in the defense ministry, which comes days after the arrest of a German foreign intelligence agency worker said to be a double agent. After federal prosecutors said authorities had conducted searches in connection with a second spying case, Chancellor Angela Merkel's coalition partner said, "U.S. embassy staff involved." So, you know, they tired of all this, but see, Illuminati Edomite doesn't truly still understand. You know, they these Edomites losing they the wisdom and the knowledge and they have lost it, what they did have at one time, because they were illuminated. They understood the book, right? So when Yah talks about in the one chapter of Abijah, how are thy hidden things and secret things sought up and searched out, O Esau, huh? That's what Yah is doing. See? And they upset about it. But you know, they knew that at one time this was gonna happen. Right? But they were illuminated. See? And again, you know, when you read 47 Yeshaya, right? The daughter of Babylon, you know, United States of America, what does Yah say? He go strip her down, take all her clothes off of her. She's going to be seen as the whore that she is. She ain't going to be able to hide. What does he say? What's that? Verse 12 and 47 you shine? He's not going to meet him as a man. Because he the most high. See? Nothing they can do about it. Nothing they can't stop it. Okay? Also, they had, you know, just again to show you how a lot of this death and destruction is not just here in Chicago. They had several people shot to death outside Houston. Okay? Many of you probably heard about that. Several people were shot to death Wednesday in Houston, suburb of Spring, Texas. Right? Said local media reported 5 people were killed. See? So it's deaths and stuff going on in a lot of places, but they make a big deal about Chicago. And again, I kind of got derailed about, you know, why they're doing it again with Chicago, same reason they're doing what they're doing in Detroit. I know, if not all of you heard about the water shutoffs in Detroit. They shut off over 250,000 people's water in Detroit, mostly us, because Detroit is basically inhabited by mostly us. From what I understand, it's like 4/5 of the population. 4/5, okay? Like 80% of the population in Detroit is, you know, they showed it obviously now, you know, probably some of you saw it, how they were marching, and it wasn't only Israel that was out there marching. You had jobs. This economic depression, call it, is hitting everybody. Okay, hitting everybody. And I got another little article. It's not little, it's big, but I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I'm just going to touch on it. It's like the last one in this little stack here, okay, about that and about a Gentile, and I'll get to it in a minute. Also, 5 people dead in East Coast storms. Twisters hit New York. And, you know, that's generally unheard of. New York don't get tornadoes, okay? But they got some tornadoes here, right? July the 9th is when they hit. And this is July 10th article, right? Twisters hits New York, thousands still without electricity. That's like an unheard of thing, tornadoes hitting New York. But they got hit, you understand, with storms, okay? So again, you can't hide. Again, like I said on the session before last, right, with Mark, about Mark Sims, right, when he said he didn't want his children to come back to the neighborhood because he wanted them to be safe. Where can you be safe if you're not with y'all? You know, I don't know where you can be safe on this earth today if you're not with the Most High. Because Yah's judgment, he's bringing forth his judgment on the inhabitants of the earth to make it rest for light to the people. 51:4 Yeshaya, right? And again, as I said on this session, I touched on Al-Maliki's political survival shows limits of U.S. influence in Baghdad. Leader was handpicked by Washington. You hear that? Leader was handpicked by Washington, but has resisted Western calls for him to share power with minority Sunnis and Kurds. See, because al-Maliki is a Shiite. And Esau did that on purpose. They knew that Iraqis, basically the Iraqis, you know, like, what, 90-some% Sunni? And they're going to put a Shiite on top of them, you know, as Esau at work, right? Divide and conquer. Cause confusion. That's what he's always about, right? You know, and like I said on this session, you know, al-Maliki was upset because he said America didn't supply him with any air power like they did, you know, the mercenary force they sent in on Gaddafi. That's the only way they was able to knock Gaddafi out, you know. Okay, this is the Chicago Sun-Times, July 11th. Again, Germany kicks out U.S. spy, right? And this girl out of Mississippi, she had HIV, and they was talking about she was cured, well, she didn't have a relapse, okay? So they say all them drugs they've been pumping her with, they thought she was cured, but she didn't have a relapse, okay? Just goes to show you, okay, you know, these drugs is not the way. You got to go to Yah, right? That's again why. When you read Yeshaya chapter 11, And again, those of you read it, and it might be all of you who listen in the room today who read it, go back and read it again. All of you who will hear this message whenever you hear it, if you haven't read it, read it. And if you have read it again. All right? And the deal is, huh? What does it say there in chapter 11, Yeshaya? Doesn't it say that Yah said he's going to reach out a second time? Now, that's the last gathering. That Yah said, you know, I call it the second gathering, the last one, right? That's the one after the temple is built and the sacrifice is put on. And Yah has come into the temple, right? Malachi chapter 3. And then those healing waters it starts coming out. They're found for uncleanness. You know, Zechariah 13:1, what is it, Yoel chapter 2, and, you know, Ezekiel chapter 47, right? He's going to bring forth those healing waters, right? This is the only way. Look, when you read that chapter 11, when you shy, doesn't it say the blind, the sick, the woman with child? It's going to be people of different nationalities, from different places in the world that's got these different afflictions, you know, that's got HIV, Huh? You follow what I'm saying? That's got AIDS. That's got Ebola. That's got whatever. Okay? Cancer. Huh? They're going to be coming to the Most High because they're going to want to get healed. And there's only y'all can heal them. See? So that's what's, you know, going to precipitate that. Right? Because you just look at the people in the world today from all this GMOs and all this crap that's being laid on the people, fluoridated, chlorinated water, huh? Water that's been contaminated with all kind of fracking materials now, right? I mean, it's a mess. You know, I said on the last session about, I think it was last session, or was it this one? It might have been in the stack on this session just played. You know, them people over there in Europe, you understand, over there in France, I think it was, you know, the frackers, they want to bring fracking over there in France. And people in France said, no way, okay? They up in arms, they ain't bringing that over here, all right? So you do that mess over in America, where you can get away with that. We don't want that over here, messing with our water and whatnot, aquifers and whatnot. Get that, don't bring that over here, but they pushing hard to bring it over there. You follow what I'm saying? Just like I just read ADM, right? Archer Daniel Midland just purchased wildflowers for over $3 billion. You follow what I'm saying? Because again, you know, they just keep piling the money on. You know, like I said in the past, those of you who privy to Yah Rice has been in the site real meticulously, you've heard me say in the past, what does the Illuminati Edomite do? First thing he going to try to do is what? He's going to try to deceive you. On you, brainwash you, brain holds you. That's why they want all the children to go to school. And they want to get you early. Preschool. You know, when you're 3, 4, they decide who's in, right? And then if they can't deceive you, brain hold you, you get beyond that, they're going to try to what? Gonna try to bribe you. What's your number? Yeah, I know they got that job. Can you hear me out there? If you can hear me, let me know. Can you hear me now? Can everybody hear me? Put them ones up. Let me see them ones. First thing they're gonna do is try to deceive you. The next thing they're gonna try to do if you get beyond that, they're gonna try to bribe you, buy you. What's your number? Okay? Because, I mean, you know, when it comes down to it, what is all they got to do? They don't care what your number is. Because, you know, if they come at you with $2 billion and you say you want $3 billion, what are they going to say? Hey, print me up another $1 billion. Run me off another $1 billion. Okay? And now they own the print press and the ink. Just run me off another $1 billion. Huh? They don't care. See? What's your number? But now, if they can't deceive you, con you, and they can't. See? And he was talking about in that last speech that he gave before they killed him the next day. Isn't that what he was saying? Think about it. Go back there and check that last speech he gave. What did he say? He said, you know, he intimated that they done already threatened him, right? Because he said what? You understand? Longevity has its place, right? He said, but I just want to do God's will. See? And when you look at him in that speech, if you haven't seen it, go ahead and look at it again and listen to it all and listen to him real close. You can see in his face that they done already threatened him. They done already told him if he don't, you understand, change his move, they was going to kill him. That's why he was talking about longevity as his place. See? Because they couldn't bind. They had been deceiving him for years with that JC stuff. He still went out basically in that, per se. You understand what I mean? But he was starting to see beyond America. He was see, what did he say? He realized that America, huh? When you listen to that Vietnam speech he gave in Riverside in New York, what was that, 1964? When you listen at that speech, what did he say? He realized that America, when he saw them divert, you understand, funds from the poverty program for everybody that was poverty-stricken here, not just Israelites, so-called African Americans, but Caucasians, whoever, right? And he said people on poverty program wasn't getting nothing but, what was it, $56 a month or something like that? You understand what I mean? And he saw them divert all of that to spending over $300,000 to bomb a Vietnamese, you understand, over there in Vietnam. Think about that, you know, because when you factor in all the money being spent militarily, it rationed out to like over $300,000 they was using to kill each Vietnamese person, soldier, what have you, over there in Vietnam. Okay? He said when he saw that, he knew, he understood that the powers that be here in America was never going to do what was needed to bring the people here in America out of poverty. Okay? It wasn't a matter of they had the resources. They had that. He could see that. But he knew then, when they diverted all their attention to spending over $300,000 to kill each Vietnamese soldier, he knew they was going to spend like just did something that, $300 and some million to the mercenaries over there that they backing. Matter of fact, it was $500 million, wasn't it? That they backing to the mercenaries. You know, the force, same force they sent against Gaddafi, they sent it against Hafez al-Assad over there to knock him out over in Syria. So they was trying to appropriate. They was talking about, you know, bringing it through Congress, $500 million to send over there to the forces that they backing against Hafez al-Assad. Now, what could that $500 million do over here in America? And like I said, right, it's 330 million, about 330 million people here, man, woman, and child. I don't care what your nationality here in America. Okay, I mean they could put $1 million on the account for everybody here. Still had what? $170 million left to send over there to the mercenary. They could have brought everybody up over here out of poverty. Put them to work, let them build the bridges and the roads and everything, keep the place clean, right? And then the people would have been spending money, right, at the store, spending money, at the cleaners, spending money, at the food store, the clothing store, going to the movies. How many people been spending money? And you tell me with the rebound of the economy. It would be to bring America up out of this impoverished state. But they're not going to do that because they don't care. See? And that's the shock that is setting in with many of these Gentiles who you know, they thought, you understand, because they were so-called white, everything was all right. Through the whiteness. That's why you got so many of these young Gentiles now. They doing what? They shooting the heroin in their arms. They smoking crank. Huh? You follow what I'm saying? They getting high. They drinking. See? Then you got others. They upset. They want to take their frustrations out. You understand? On somebody, you know, brain hole. They get all of the, they go to the white, you know, supremacist movements or something. And they want to claim it's black is the problem. Why they ain't got, you know, why they choose to just say, you know, they want to blame somebody and they've been brain hole, they've been in the wrong people. You know what I'm saying? But this is Illuminati Edomite. And it's really working the Illuminati Edomite. They chopped up too, right? Right. Yeah, I know they chopped on all that, right? Can you hear me now? Say, yep, okay, yeah, you know. He got his hook in. I knew he would. You know, because I could tell the session the way they were, and it was pre-recorded. I knew they would be attacking the Q&A. Okay? I knew that. All right? Because, again, the message is so real, they don't want you to hear it. But, again, like I've said in the past, that's a giveaway right there. It's not, if I'm here talking about Jesus or Yeshua or Allah or Buddha, you think they would be hitting the message? It would be fine-tuned. It would be so clear, I could probably be talking and crack your crystal in your kitchen or something. You see what I'm saying? If I was talking about them idols and them images in any shape, form, or fashion, right? If I was talking about Judaism, it'd be clear as a bell. But this truth, they're attacking. That's right. To the core. To the core, Shah. That is absolutely correct. And again, that's Yeshaya chapter 28, is it not? It's a vexation only for them to understand the report. They're upset. Okay? But again, it's just to bring this country out of, you know, the impoverished state that will there up if they really wanted to do that. See? And again, this is what many Gentiles, so-called Caucasians, you know, so-called white folks, Caucasians, this is what they're seeing now. And it shocked them down to their socks. Okay? Because where they had them six-figure jobs, you know, making $100,000, $200,000 a year, and I'm getting ready to read about one in a second, now they down there, some of them's on food stamps, some of them's on aid, and they don't like it. Now they understand, because what's happening to them, what we've been going through all these years. See? You know, you understand, like in The Nutty Professor, what did Eddie Murphy, one of the characters, his brother say, I can relate. Now they can relate. See? Okay? But, again, back to this article, okay, the Edomites, you know, offensive on Gaza here in this article, 85 dead. You can see the toll coming up every day. And this is July 11th, okay? And, again, here's another article, July 11th. The Edomite desperate for new ideas, new leadership. They saying, you know, the Israelis, the Edomites, they're desperate for new ideas, new leadership. But there are no new ideas, okay? They, you know, stand there, and it doesn't make any difference about leadership. Whatever Edomite they put up there is not going to be able to do anything more than the one that was up there, the Netanyahu or any of the rest. The one that tried to do a little something, right? Yitzhak Rabin, right? What happened to him? See? The Edomites, that you know, super crazy faction of Edomites that's always going to be in control there in the land now, because that's where it's headed, right? Yah is undressing them and making them seem for who and what they are. They killed him, Yitzhak Rabin, back there in 95. So they're making whatever, okay? Now, also July 11th in the Chicago Sun-Times, stocks fall upon fears of European debt crisis. Okay, so many people jumped out of the stock, you know, the kind of stocks went down because of the situation over there in Europe. You know, that's a signal that things is getting worse, you know, because it's, you know, happening over there in Europe, you know what I mean? And a lot of people know that these stocks is manipulated anyway, like I just said on this last session, right? And here's another article, Chicago Tribune, July 11th. You know, Germany ejects top spy in U.S. embassy. And, you know, some more about the Gaza, Edomite striking evoke wars past. You know, like the Six-Day War. And then they had another little caption here, phone app alerts users to rockets fired from Gaza. Okay? Yeah, you know, that they got an app that lets them know when the brothers supposedly, you know, and I ain't doubting that the brothers shoot some rockets from Gaza, but it's tantamount to a firecracker, okay? I mean, they got them antiquated rockets, they ain't really got nothing, you know what I'm saying? And they just shoot them things out of frustration, okay? And Esau does his best to capitalize on it to get some kind of mileage out of that. Say, oh, we got to do something. You know, they're shooting at us, right? And here's another big article out of Chicago Tribune. Changes afoot at Landmark. Park officials warn against two projects planned near the Grand Canyon. One would alter its views, another would tap the area's precious water. You hear that? They're trying to get water out the Grand Canyon. That's how bad now. The water is dissipating so rapidly, okay? They got this plan. I wish I could show you the picture. They got a huge picture here of the Grand Canyon showing you the water that you know, goes through the Grand Canyon. And again, you know, it says the Colorado River, that's what this is, winds through the Grand Canyon as seen from Mojave Point on the southern rim. If developers get their way, this end of the canyon could look very different. But they want to tap that water, huh? But they almost don't have any water in many of these states, as we said on the previous sessions. Now, this article, like I was just touching on, about how many of these Gentiles now are affected by this recession, depression. Now they're understanding what poor folks has been going through for years. Now it's hit them real hard. And they got a picture here. This is out of the Chicago Tribune, July 11th. They got the picture of the front of a Mercedes Benz, right? Just the front of it. And it says, driving my Mercedes to pick up food stamps. You hear that? It's a big article. I read the whole thing, okay, the other night. Big article. And it's this Gentile woman out of Hartford, Connecticut. And she used to produce shows, you know, for TV news. I'm not going to read the whole article. I'm just going to scat through it, right? But says she had a grand year. It was a grand year for her in 2007. She moved back home from San Diego, where I produced Good Morning San Diego. You know, like Good Morning America. And she says, I quickly secured my next big gig as a producer in Boston for the 6 p.m. news. The pay wasn't great, but it was more than enough to support me, and my boyfriend was making good money too as a copy editor for the Hartford Current. Okay? And so her and her boyfriend hooked up, right? And she found herself pregnant in February 2008. She thought it was one child, ended up being twins. And she said that kind of shook her a little bit, but it was okay. And she said, because between the two of them, right, they had bought a house. Okay, they got a house, and the house cost $240,000. And they said with the situation, the subprime situation in 08, after they paid, you know, got the house for $240,000, all of a sudden now it's worth $150,000. They lost $90,000, like, you know, in the bat of an eye, right? And then she said, but you know, it was still okay. They were still all right, right? And then she said, 2 weeks before my children were born, my future husband found himself staring at a pink slip. The days of unemployment turned into weeks, months, and eventually years. Now, I skipped, let me go back. Now, she says, then she said, just 3 weeks after we closed on the house, the market crashed. The house we paid $40,000 was suddenly worth $150,000. The boyfriend, and they got married, right? And she said 2 weeks before her children were born, right, her future husband, he got a pink slip. Then our children were born 6 weeks early. They were just 3 pounds each at birth, barely the length of my shoe. We fed them through a little tube attached to our pinky fingers because their mouths don't kind of increase in size. She says, we went through dozens of weeks, you know, dealing with the children, right? And the deal was they had to buy this baby formula that was $15 a can. Now, check this out. And they went through that for a dozen weeks where they had to buy that baby formula like every day, $15 a can. And he don't have a job. Now check this out. In just 2 months, we've gone from making a combined $120,000 a year to making just $25,000 and leeching out funds to a mortgage we couldn't afford. Our savings dwindled, then disappeared. She said, it's not easy to qualify. You know, no, wait a minute. She said, so I did what I had to do. I signed up for Medicaid and the special supplemental nutritional program for women, infants, and children. It's not easy. To qualify, you must be pregnant or up to 6 months postpartum. I had to fill out at least 6 forms and furnish my Social Security card, birth certificate, and marriage license. She said she sat through exam meetings and screenings. She said they had a lot of questions about the house. Wasn't it an asset? Hadn't we just bought it? You know, they sent it up through the ringer, right? They questioned every last cent we ever made. Did we have stock options or pensions? Did we have savings? I had to send them my 3 most recent check stubs to prove I was making as little as I said I was. On top of this, I had to get my vitals checked, blood work taken to determine whether I was at risk of improper nourishment without the program. It's very bourgeois, not, but I did it, okay? Driving to the WIC office the first time was scary. It wasn't an office like I thought it would be. It was the basement of a dreary church. We sat in pews waiting to be called for our coupons, which would get us some cans of tuna, some Cheerios, a gallon of milk, baby formula. Using the coupons was even worse. The stares, the false concern, the pity, the outrage. I hated it. One time, an old, kind-looking man with a bit of a hunch was standing behind me with just a 6-pack of soda waiting to check out. The entire contents of my cart was displayed out on the conveyor belt. When he noticed the flash of large white paper stubs in my hand, he touched me on the shoulder. I was scared that he was going to give me money. Instead, he gave me a small rectangular card. He asked me to accept Jesus into my heart so that my troubles would disappear. I think I managed a half smile before breaking into long jogging strides out of there. The workers calling after me as to whether I still wanted my receipt. Okay? She flew up out of there. You understand? Now check this out, right? I'm telling you, said that was one of the better times. You hear that? Once a girl at the register actually stood up for me when an older mother of 3 saw the coupons and started chastening my purchase of root beer. They were buy 2 get 1 free at $1 a pop. Surely you don't need those, the lady behind her said. That's when she thought she had food stamps, right? She said, you don't need that, right? Okay, now. Okay, said WIC pays for juice for you people. That's what the woman behind her said. Said WIC pays for juice for you people. Alright? The girl who couldn't have been more than 19, who was working the register, flashed her eyes up to my face and saw my grimace as I white knuckled the counter in front of me, preparing my cold shoulder. And the chick working the register, she said to the woman that said this to this girl, who are you, the soda police? Say, she asked loudly, say, anyone bother you about the pound of candy you're buying? Okay? Say, the woman huffed off to another register, and I'm sure she complained about that girl. I mean, while thanked profusely. Okay? Got his son, she said. It softly, I know what this 19-year-old working the cash ready. Now check this out. Say, that's the funny thing about being poor. Everywhere. That was especially true about my husband's Mercedes. Over and over again, asked why he kept that car. Offering to sell it in their yards on the internet for us. You can't be that bad off a distant relative. Set that baby in all its glory. Talk about the Mercedes, right? Sometimes it was more direct, all from a place of love, of course. Sell the Mercedes, a friend said to me. He doesn't get to keep his toys now, right? But it wasn't a toy. It was paid off. My husband bought the car in full long before we met. Were we supposed to trade it in for a lousier car we'd have to make payments on? Only to have that less reliable car break down on us? And even if we had wanted to do that, here's what people don't understand. The reality of poverty can spring quickly, while the psychological effects take longer to surface. When you lose a job, your first thought isn't, oh my God, I'm poor. I better sell all my nice stuff. It's, I need another job. Now, when you're scrambling, you hang on to the things that work, that bring you some comfort. That Mercedes was the one reliable, trustworthy thing in our lives. She said, that's how I found myself one dreary day when my Honda wouldn't start in my husband's Mercedes at the WIC office. I parked gingerly over one of the many potholes, shut off the purring engine and locked it. Head held high and not looking in either direction. To this day, it's the single most embarrassing thing I've ever done. Not one spoke to me. No one spoke to me, but they did stare, miles agape. The poverty-stricken mothers struggling with infant car seats, paperwork, and their toddlers never took their eyes off me. The tall blonde girl walking with purpose on heels from her Mercedes to their group. I didn't feel animosity coming from them, more wonderment, maybe a bit of resentment. The most embarrassing part was how I felt about myself, how I had to internalize the message of what poor people should or should not have, that I felt ashamed to be there with that car, getting food, as if I were not allowed the food because of the car, as if I was. Or a bad person. We have in med school. Check this out. President Barack Obama's programs, from the extended unemployment benefits to the tax-free allowance for short selling a home we couldn't afford, allowed us to crawl our way out of the hole. But what I learned there will never leave me. We didn't deserve to be poor any more than we deserve to be rich. Poverty is a circumstance, not a value judgment. I still have to remind myself sometimes that I was my harshest critic, that the judgment of the disadvantaged comes not just from conservative politicians and internet trolls. It came from me even as I was living it. We still have the Mercedes. Now, again, see, this is what people have to actually experience before they can kind of start having some empathy and understanding from people who are caught and trapped in poverty. See? When they started to understand what those people go through. And this was a young Gentile girl, so you know she had all of the opportunities, like she just said, right? They out of the hole now. The husband got a job that's paying him good. You see what I'm saying? She still wasn't working as the writing of this. She's going to school. He got enough, making enough money where he can take everything and send her to grad school. See what I'm saying? But again, these is Gentiles. Now, how much worse is it for descendants of Israel that's under a curse, and, you understand, the descendants of Israel that's descended out of Jerusalem that's under a double curse? Huh? How bad is it? And again, it has to be bad in order to get some of us to stop and consider, huh? And even some of us, less amount, out of the ones who stop and consider that turn back to the Most High. And even less still that stop and consider, awaken to the fact they Israel, turn back to the Most High, but even some of us still a lesser amount who actually going to be with the Most High and obey the Most High and follow this all the way through. See, because every step you get less and less, less and less, less and less. As I just said on this session, you still got people who are understanding, you know, descendants of Israel who've awakened to the fact they Israel, right? But they still hung up, snared up. Just like Yah said in the 42nd chapter of Yeshaya, what did he say? But they all snared in holes. See? And it's that, you know, what Yah, you understand, over there in Yeremia chapter 18. See, he's the potter, we're the clay. But in order for Yah to rework us, to remold us, to refashion us, we've got to turn back and give ourselves to him with all our heart and all our soul. And then he can do that. Okay? Now, it's a couple of things I want to mention before we get on the questions, right? Because I've been meaning to mention this. You know, when you see mule in the book, that's an implant. There were no mules back in ancient times. Mules had not been created yet by man, just like the chicken and the turkey. That's why you don't see chicken and turkey in the law. You understand? It's being unclean because they wasn't created yet. You follow me? That those man-made creations, you know, hooking up two opposite situations that would never hook up otherwise. Okay? And that's how the mule came about. But there were no mules back then. So that's an insert. Okay? Same thing with the word corn. Okay? The word corn, I looked it up here last night, right, in the Columbian Encyclopedia. Okay? And when you look it up, it tells you that the word corn, you understand, the Gentiles out of Europe, in places where it says wheat or oats or barley, they would put corn. Okay? Because they looked at any grain as like a corn. All right? So when you see corn, it doesn't necessarily mean the corn that you know, that usually pops up into your mind, yellow or blue corn. You follow what I'm saying? And many of us, I'm sure out there, don't even know what blue corn looks like because you've probably never seen it. Okay? They got a bunch of that down in Mexico. I've seen some here. But the point being is, and I've touched on this before real brief, so I'm going to say it again. In 1500 CE AD, after the medieval period, Esau put a lot of things in the book that weren't there prior. One, you know, some of the things, and I mentioned this in the past, you know, the chapters and verses. There were no chapters and verses in the book before 1500 CE AD. He put them in there sometime after then. You know, and again, more likely the corn, the mule, you see what I'm saying? And different other things that he's inserted in there. As I said time and time again, when you're reading this book, you always got to remember that the Illuminati Edomite has tampered with it. Okay? So don't try to figure out the time frame from Kings and Chronicles, because he got all that messed up. You know, he's got governors overlapping, and that didn't happen. That only happened in maybe one or two cases. You know, I know the case with, who was that, Uzziah that was turned into a leper. You understand? That's when I think his son Jotham, or Jehoram, he was ruling for his father. His father was in the several house. That was an overlapping. But other than that, there were no overlapping. When one governor died, another governor came up. Simple as that. See? But Esau got it all misconstrued because, again, he's messing with that time frame. He does not want us to understand the time frame. Okay? Simple as that. You know, that's, again, you know why. You understand? Like I'm saying about, you know, 1964 with the Civil Rights Act, right? They saw Martin Luther King when he gave that speech, you understand, when he knew that, you understand, that he started attacking the Vietnam War, and he knew that America wasn't going to do what it took, the powers that be, to bring everybody out of poverty here. That's when he took that stance. That's when he really started seeing, you know, profoundly into America. And how, you understand, this is all a bunch of crap. This patriotism and all that waving the flag nonsense, we, you understand, we ain't Americans, and they don't really view us as such. We need to start looking up out of here. When he said that 3 years earlier, in 1967, 1 year later, he was dead. And they had Jesse Jackson for the people, as they still got today for you. You know, old chitlin-eating, you know, ham-hog-eating Jesse Jackson. You know, sellout. With the Sharptons and the Farrakhan, all of them sellouts. Okay? Simple as that. I do not retract one iota what I've said about them, and I don't care who is it. And I take anybody to task about it, because if they were truly about, you understand, the truth, they would be talking about the same thing that we're talking about here today. Simple as that, because this book only puts forth one thing, Genesis through Malachi. Now, how these people get into it, and they come out with something else, far as I'm concerned, they got something else in their heart that, as it says in the 42nd chapter of Yeshaya, verse 17, they get turned back. Because it's too late in the day to come up with a new book and disseminate it to all the inhabitants of the earth so that it will be near everybody. Everybody have a chance to read it and come into this one understanding. Okay? It's too late for that. Okay? Okay? Because we got a guy here. Okay. Yes, and he was attacking me the other day with some others. But he was attacking them because they into, you know, the idol. But he's attacking me and said, threw my face up on the screen and said that, you know, basically he said I was a liar because he said what I was talking about the Palestinians being Israel, that's a lie. So, but he didn't get into Ezekiel chapter 16 and you know, explain that chapter. And I know he comes into this site at different times and listens to Yah Righteous. So I hope when he hears this, with Ezekiel chapter 16, he's watching and listening to us. So when you hear this, I want you to deal with Ezekiel 16 and tell the people who Samaria is. Matter of fact, just explain that chapter, Ezekiel 16. Unless you do like you always do and say, throw that out because that's not relevant. You know, that's a mythological chapter. Like you do with the book of Daniel, like you do with David, like you do with Solomon, like you do with Saul, like you do with Jacob, like you do with Abraham. Because you lack the understanding to understand those situations because we're dealing with human beings. And again, and I'll say this to you. Also, I want you to say whether you circumcised or not. Because what you say, I don't think you are. So, bring that up about yourself. Say if you circumcised, because I'm circumcised. You know, to keep from being crass, I would show my circumcision on the screen if I could, but I don't want to be crass. You're supposed to be so truthful, you understand? Let the people know whether you circumcised or not. Okay? You know who I'm talking about. Right here in Chicago, not far away from Yah Righteous. Like I said, I don't know exactly where you live, but I think you don't live no more, maybe about 2.5 miles, 3 miles from us. Okay? You in Englewood too, West Englewood, last I heard. Okay? So when you hear this, do a show on that and explain Ezekiel chapter 16. I ain't going to ask you to explain Daniel because you said just throw that whole book out. So, you know what I mean? Like you said, throw the last three verses in chapter 52 of Yeshaya out, right? So just explain Ezekiel 16. Okay? Do that. I appreciate it. Now, what's your question? What's your question? Come on. Oh, yeah. One more thing. When I was talking about the Christmas and all them, you know, them hella days, you know, the heathen, I didn't mention Hanukkah. That's a hella day, too. That's one of their messed up days. That's one of Esau's days. So throw that in with Christmas and Easter and Valentine's Day and Thanksgiving and, you know, 4th of July and Labor Day and New Year's Day and all the rest of that garbage. So what's your question?
Is that here at the top?
Oh, okay. Okay, this, you remember me? Okay, if you replace the word corn with wheat body, does this change the meat offering of first fruits in? Okay, well, again, you understand, we don't know what they replaced wheat, you know what I mean, what was in the place of corn when we see corn. We don't really know what was there, right? But like I've said in the past, I don't worry about that, because me, myself, personally, I don't know. As I was saying to Yeshaya and Yadid and Yakoya earlier, I don't know just, you know, when corn actually came on the scene. Now, some of you out there might have read some, but I mean, you know, I've heard that the Native Americans, right, the so-called Indians, came up with the corn, right? But where did they come from? They came from the Indus Valley region, from over there in what's called Indian Pakistan today. So, you understand, did they bring corn with them? You follow me? I mean, real corn, see? So, you know, to me, that's neither here nor there. You understand? Because like I've said before, I know unequivocally, when we get to the land, this Jerusalem movement, in the process of Yah's temple being built, Yah going to reveal a lot of things to us that might be a little suspect here or there now. You follow what I'm saying? Because I know he's going to prepare these Levites. He's going, first of all, he's going to make it plain who the Levites are. Now, earlier today, I saw this person that came in the room call herself Lady Levi. Now, I don't know how she knows that she's descending out of Because she could very well be descended out of Benjamin or Yahuda. See? Because there's no way to discern that. Yah is going to have to make that plain once we get back. He's going to have to make it plain who everybody is and who everybody, what tribe they're from. And I have no doubt he's going to do that. Okay? And I have no doubt he's going to straighten all of that, you know, the stuff that's suspect out. Because he's going to prepare the whites. He's going to make it plain who they are. He's going to start preparing them. That the seed of Zadok, the high priest, he's going to prepare him. He's going to make it plain who he is. He's going to start preparing them. As he's going to be prepared, you know, giving more of all of us more and more illumination. Okay, there's only so much he can do with us on this side. Okay? But he does enough to where we can get home. That's without a doubt. What's next?
It does in the pig.
Okay, does a man have to be circumcised before he can enter Jerusalem, or can he have it done after? Now, you know, Yah is greatly merciful, and it's possibly some are going to. I don't see that happening with this movement, with the Jerusalem movement. It's my man, I would think all the males that come back in this movement are going to be circumcised, because I don't think if they're not circumcised, first of all, I don't think they can stay on this path. I really don't. They're going to get turned around, right? They'll fall off the path. But the ones that come in the second gathering, the last one, I would think it's possibly it will be some males in that gathering that won't be circumcised, and they'll be circumcised when they get back. That's the law. You all the males got to be circumcised, and as I said in the past, all the people have to be circumcised in the foreskin of their heart to the Most High. What's next? Okay,
Right there.
Okay, Pishu, what's your thoughts on this ISIS taking over cities in Iraq and Syria? Do you think the strikes on the Palestinians will hasten the Edomites' judgment? Yah bless. I hope. Yes, that'll be. I mean, because we know that Yah, brothers and sisters, to be wiped out. We know this, right? But and as I said, you know, on this session, Yah is steadily peeling the onion, and I would just about think the Edomites have been totally brought down to butt nakedness. You know what I mean? They're seen as who and what they are, for all who needs to see them for who and what they are. Quite naturally, you know, the majority of the people don't know anything about Esau. Okay, when I say the people, I'm talking about people, period, not just Israel. Okay. Most of the people are oblivious. You know, they don't really know what's going on. Okay? Now, quite naturally, you got some people here and there of the people who do know. You follow what I'm saying? You know, but they will. You would never know that unless they actually conveyed that to you and said some things. You had a conversation with them or heard them say certain things. Okay? But the elite do know. All right? The elite know. Okay? We know they know. You follow what I'm saying? Because they're in consideration mode. The Illuminati Edomite, he knew it before it even happened. Like I said, they saw it back in 1896. That's why they started moving in. All right? But the kings and the queens and these princes, they didn't really start considering it until 2004. You know, Yeshua chapter 52, when they got sprinkled. And then that's when they went in consideration mode. So they've been in consideration mode now, what? Almost 10 years. Okay? Real close to 10 years, being September, and they watching this thing. And you've got other Gentiles who see what's going on and who are knowledgeable. I know a few of those myself, okay? Gentiles that I've met over the years, professional. And they know what's going on. They see, okay? And they watching. You understand what I'm saying? And you understand, as far as ISIS, again, that's the Sunnis, from what I can see. That's the Sunnis, you know. They and they coming at al-Maliki because they know he's a stooge. They know he's a sellout, you see? And they're probably backed by Iran and probably Russia, too. You follow what I'm saying? And they got weapons, and they coming. And they're going to run al-Maliki up out of there. Okay? And again, this is, it's got to fall that way, and they're going to more than likely take control of Iraq, Assyria, and they Sunnis. And again, when Yah Righteous comes to the land and start tearing down that El Asmas and that Dome of the Rock, they're going to attack us. Okay, Zechariah 12, Zechariah 13, Micah chapter 5. They're going to attack us. Okay, because that's what we got to do, team. Micah chapter 5, we got to get rid of all idols and images. Yah is not going to coexist with idolatry. He's not going to coexist with them Edomites the way they are. That's why he's going to get rid of them first. And again, that's the sign in 66 Yeshaya, right? You understand? That's the sign when the Edomites get judged over there, you know, and you know what I mean, get run out and burned up in their land. That's the sign that's going to go out to the nations that have not what? Heard Yah's fame nor seen his glory. Okay, to Spain, Tarshish, to Yvonne, Greece, Tubal, Lud, or Lud, however you choose to pronounce it, right? And whatever other nations, because they're gonna come out and they're gonna be sent out, because again, just look that up with 52 Yeshaya. What does Yah say? The whole world is going to be watching when he brings again Zion, when he brings his glory, his praise out of the midst of her, her being the daughter of Babylon. So we know that that 66 Yeshaya can't happen before that. Has to happen before that. Okay, because, you know, when Yah brings the Jerusalem movement up out here, everybody going to see Yah's glory. See? About the Edomites that's over there in the land when they get run out and judged. And again, just factor that in with Ezekiel chapter 35. What does Yah say there? He's going, when he has judged Esau, the Edomites, he shall make himself known amongst his people. And again, most Israel, and I do mean most, they don't even know they're Israel, so you know they don't know nothing about Esau. So what's going to make them know, you understand, about the Most High when Esau gets judged? It's got to be when Yah judges the Edomites, huh? Burns them up in their land. That's going to trigger, at not long after that, the elite of the world, these kings and these queens and these princes and these different Gentiles who are in consideration mode, who have seen the flyer, read it, gotten it, have been on the site or on the site, listening, watching, going through the site, huh? Have, what does it say in Yeshaya chapter 60? Arise and shine, for the glory of Yah is risen upon thee. Yah is lifting up his arm from the midst of her, the daughter of Babylon. Huh? And what does it say in Yeshaya chapter 60? For the earth is in darkness, and the people of the earth in what? Gross darkness. But the Gentiles shall come to thy light, and kings to the brightness of thy rising. And that's when Yah brings these Gentiles and these kings and these queens and these princes, also Yeshaya chapter 49, to get his movement to convey it to Jerusalem. That's when, from the destruction of the Edomites, from their judgment, that's when these Israelites, wherever they are, when they see people that look just like them, coming from the same, what does it say? Discontented, indebted, distressed position that they're in, get embraced by the power elite. And I said it like that because I'm taking you to 1 Samuel chapter 22, right? The distressed, the indebted, and the discontented. Like Solomon says, nothing new up under the sun, right? Same thing still going on. Right? When they see people that look just like them coming from the same situation, and again, factor in Amos 9:9, what did Yah say? I'm going to sift the children of Israel like corn. There's that corn again, right? In a sieve. Not the least grain shall fall upon the earth. Who's he talking about? The ones who's turned to him, who's totally about him. They're going to gravitate when these elite come to the arm of Yah. Because again, they're listening. Again, this is not the first time this has happened. We said this not long ago, didn't we? This is not the first time. Just go. Isn't that what Cyrus did? Didn't Yah raise up Cyrus? What did he say? All Israel, they want to go up to Jerusalem and build this second temple to the Most High. You can go up. Didn't Cyrus give them whatever they needed?
Yeah.
Okay? And again, not only Cyrus did this, didn't Darius the Persian, Darius the Great do this? All you got to do is go to Ezra chapter 5 and 6 and read 5 and 6. Huh? He did the same thing. Didn't Xerxes Ahasuerus basically do this for Mordecai and Esther? He said, hey, You understand? He counteracted what he had signed, you know, the day earlier, right? When he couldn't sleep. We talked about this not long ago. Didn't Artaxerxes do this with Ezra? Huh? Go there and read. You understand? In the book of Ezra, and pick it up at chapter 7. Because that's when Ezra starts talking about himself in his time. See? And then when you finish reading the rest of Ezra, from 7 on to the end, then go to the book of Nehemiah and read. Didn't Artaxerxes do it again with him? And made him governor over Jerusalem. So this is not going to be the first time that this is taking place. Nothing new up under the sun. See, the only difference at this time is this is the finality. Okay? Instead of being just a part of the world, this time it's going to be the whole world. Because this is it. This is Yah setting up his kingdom as we speak. That's why you got all these different Israelite groups. Huh? But again, it's only one movement that's talked about, Genesis through Malachi, that represents the Most High. And I don't care who don't like me saying that or who don't agree with that. That's a fact. Show me in the book, anybody out there that hears this, show me in the book where it talks about it's going to be two or three or four or five or six other movements all about the Most High. Show me that, because I ain't seen it. Maybe I missed it. Okay, what's next? What do you think about the Chikungunya virus? I don't even know what that is. That's a new one on me. Spreading down there in the Caribbean. Okay, it's spreading from Miami to the British Virgin Islands right now. Spreading into South America, slowly taking root. Supposedly some folks down in Mississippi brought it from the... some people down in Mississippi. I wonder what people were that. Yes, who they gonna claim brought it, right? And you know that's mostly Israel in those areas. Yeah, that again, they always, I mean, they blame the housing crisis on us too, ain't they? I mean, they blaming the whole recession on us too, getting houses we couldn't afford. They blame that on us too, right? I mean, it's always gonna be blamed on us, right? But again, if it's some kind of a virus that's spreading, it's them spreading it. But at the same time, it's Yah. You follow what I'm saying? It's Yah working through the sword, right? Jeremiah 25:14-33. It's Yah working through the sword. And again, didn't Yah say this in the curse? Deuteronomy 28:15-67. He gonna put all the diseases of Egypt and new diseases on us if we refuse to turn. Because that's what it takes for these hard-headed, recalcitrant, stiff-necked, stubborn, Israelites. Because they, you know, we stiff-necked as a people. Rebellious. See? We refuse to hear. And then we want to do only what we want to do. Just like that lady Levi who was in there. I'm looking at the screen, and she come up with this Deuteronomy 14th chapter 21st, but not to boil a kid in his mother's milk. You know what they call that, don't you? They call that veal. So I don't eat veal. Okay? I ain't never ate veal. You follow what I'm saying? And I've been knowing about that since back in the 70s. I don't eat no veal. Because that's a calf, a young calf, that ain't been born, that's in that sack, or in his mother's milk around it. They take it out of there, and people boil that, and they eat that veal. See? But we're not supposed to deal with that. But that has nothing to do with what was actually said in the room earlier. You understand? I saw it up on the screen. I saw some brothers, you understand? And or some sisters tried to, didn't try to. They can decent manner. Calcitrant, stiff-necked, and stubborn. We, as I said in the past, the average one of us cannot take constructive criticism. And that's what this is all about. So again, if you can't take constructive criticism, you might as well leave out this room. Because if you come in this room, you understand your righteousness, and you saying something that's incorrect, somebody in this room is going to check it. Guaranteed. Okay? So if you can't take constructive criticism, if you think somebody's jumping on you or beating up on you, and you so fragile and mentally that you can't take on, pack up your bags, go on over to one of them other rooms. Simple as that. Okay? Because if you can't take correction, You understand? You ain't gonna be about y'all righteousness. Cause that's what this whole thing is about. I mean, that's what I talk about when I make a mistake. Didn't I just talk about how I made a mistake here the last session the day was playing about the brother and the sister they call here? And that was my fault. That wasn't their fault. It was my position to check them as I have checked them before and others. Because people get excited sometimes and they lose focus. But that's for my job to keep them focused. And I messed up. And y'all let me know the very next day. That's what I'm talking about. See? We got to be able to understand when y'all corrects us, he cares about us. And if we didn't care about the people in this room when we see them making a mistake, and we didn't care about it, we wouldn't say anything. Just like you don't hear, you know, a lot of these idolaters and these different movements, idolaters, churches, you know, mosques, temples, or whatever. People make a mistake, they don't say nothing to them. You know why? Because they wanted to drop that donation in the basket. They wanted to send that donation, so they don't want to upset them. See, like I just said in this last session, you know, and said it in the past, we don't ask nobody for nothing other than to serve y'all. Be serve the Most High. That's what we asking you to do. We ain't asking you for no money. We ain't asking you for no gifts. You understand? Keep your gifts to yourself. If you want to help this movement, you can, but send it to the movement. You follow what I'm saying? But you ain't got to do that if you don't want to. Simple as that. I mean that. Because y'all been taking care of this movement from day one. I've talked about how this movement sprung up and how he's always funded it. He's been able to do everything it needed to do. And it's going to always be like that. Because if I go wrong, he's going to get rid of me and somebody else, he'll pop right up here in this spot and keep right on rolling. Simple as that. Blessings, Yahuda. Are you aware of the temple being built in Brazil? Again, no, I'm not aware of that. And matter of fact, whoever this is, IHUH forever, what is that? What is that IHUH stuff? What does that mean? Huh? Put it up there on the screen and tell us what that IHUH, what is that? I don't, you know, temples in Brazil, that don't mean nothing. That's just, you know, exercise in futility. It ain't no different than... You understand the temples and the churches and mosques and all that crap, wherever they putting that stuff. All that stuff is eventually going to come down. Like I said about that conversation that I had with Alicia back January 2nd, 1998, when I told him, I said, brother, when he was talking about, you know, brother, you know, our forefathers had plenty of temples. I said, yeah, that's why we in captivity today. And that's when he got quiet. You know that. And I said, brother, look, I said, you know, the deal is, when the dust settles, it's not going to be but one temple on this earth, and that's the temple of Yah atop Mount Moriah in Jerusalem. That's it. And after a few seconds, you understand, when the sister who I didn't know on the phone spoke up and said, what about that, Alicia? And then a few seconds went by again, and then he come back, he said, brother, you right. And I'm like, right is right. It's only for us to plug into what's right, do what's right, to bring all this nonsense to an end forever. What's next?
This is it right here. He's saying right here what IHUH meant. Yah is IHUH.
Yeah, but what is IHUH? I mean, what does that stand for? Because that ain't what we see here. Okay? So what you need to do is change that to YHWH forever. Okay? Because I don't know what no IHUH is. I ain't never seen that. Now, I've seen four other variations of YHWH, but that ain't one of them. I've seen IHWH, okay? And all of them is Esau's mess, brain hosing, okay? Y'all has asked me to ask you where you got it from. Okay, what you got here? The letter first. No, again, no, it doesn't. The Y basically is the Yod that preceded the I. The I comes from the Lat. So we go back to the beginning. Okay? Simple as that. See? And the W is two U's, they say no longer the U. Okay? So that's another thing. We need to get out of this, you know, wanting to be different crap. Okay? It's YHWH, yesterday, today, and forever as far as English goes. Now, when Yah turns us that pure language, we know the name is Yah. We know that's how it's pronounced. In any language, it's Yah. You understand? Again, when then, boom. You follow what I'm saying? We'll have a language to go with it, and we'll have the characters. Okay? But you can take that IHUH and drop it in the garbage. That's dead. Okay? Because, again, the Y preceded the I. Okay? What's next? Can you please clear up the drinking of cow's milk debate? Again, for someone earlier in the room, was not clear. Okay, the point is that when you go to Deuteronomy chapter 32, Yah says there, that's part of the diet. Even though, you know, when you listen to that conversation I had with David Ben Israel here the other year, a couple years ago, he didn't want it to be that. 2.5 years ago, he didn't want it to be that. Okay? But that's what it is. That's part of the diet. See what I'm saying? Yah says there, the milk of sheep, okay? Not the milk of kine. We can eat the butter from kine or cattle, cow. The butter's all right because it melts at room temperature. So you know it's going to melt at 98.6? You know it's going to melt at that temperature, which is body temperature, right? So it's okay, but not supposed to drink cow's milk. That's for cows. Because, as I've said in the past, that creates casein in the lungs, which is not good. That's mucus. Okay? It's not good for you. That's why y'all said the milk of sheep, because it doesn't create mucus in the system. So that knocks out anything made out of milk. You follow what I'm saying? In the sense of cheese, ice cream, milk. You follow what I'm saying? We ain't supposed to fool with that. That's why y'all got the milk of sheep, okay? The pure blood of the grape. You know, not grape drink, grape juice, pure grape juice. That's why it's hard getting that now, because the Illuminati might knows how good that is for the body, you know, the air that is. I've talked about it in the past. Go back to the site. I can't remember. Maybe, you understand, Yeshaya, Yadita, they can tell you, Yeremia, they can tell you where that is. All right, but I've talked about that in the past, maybe about again, year and a half ago. What's next? For land with our brothers, how far along are we before Yah runs the Edomites out of the land? I mean, you know, sure, I wish I knew that too. Okay, but Yah says what? He's going to do it suddenly. Okay, 49:19, Yeremia, 44, Yeremia, he's going to do it suddenly, okay? And that's all I can say on that. He's going to do it suddenly, just like what he says there, okay? I know it's 44:19 is the one spot, okay? And 50:44, I think, is it 44? Yeah, 50:44, Yeremia is the other spot. He's going to run them out. You know, now, again, what he's doing is he's totally, again, undressing Esau. He's revealing him for the liar, for the deceiver, for the murderer that he, that they are. Again, Hosea 9, verse 13, they're over there murdering our brothers and sisters, the so-called Palestinians. Doesn't it say that in Hosea 9, verse 13? We got it in the flight. They will deliver their children up to the murderer. And that's what he's doing, murdering them. And this ain't just started. He's been doing this since 1948. Like I said, look at that Democracy Now! On the 8th of this month and see what that Edomite who's on there, you understand, whose father was a general back during the time of the Six-Day War back in 1967. Look and see what he says. He's running all this down himself. There's plenty of people know this. There's plenty of people know this. You follow what I'm saying? And what they've been doing to the so-called Palestinians. You follow what I'm saying? That I was called a liar the other day for saying that they're Israel. But like I said, that person who called me a liar on his show, you understand, and said I was lying, they're not, the children of Israel. I want him to explain to me Ezekiel 16. He don't have to just explain to me because I ain't nobody. Just put it up on, just, you know, I hope he is. Just do it on your show. One of your shows, explain Ezekiel 16. I want to hear your explanation of Ezekiel 16, because somebody got to be Samaria. Simple as that. I mean, it's unequivocal that the brothers in Dimona are the fulfillment. They are Sodom and her daughters. Okay? That's without a doubt. Because they got Sodomites among them that they've been knowing since 83, that came out here 5 years ago in 09. And it's up on the internet. You follow me? They got Sodomites. They got a trial over there. I haven't heard the outcome of the trial. Okay? So that you know, I said that on the very first show we did with Mark Sims. I also said that, you know, our fighting them when they came back in May 1993, that was y'all bringing back Samaria to their former state that sits on the left side of your rules, Matt's left hand. But since you disagree with that, somebody got to be Samaria, so who is it? Again, we're going into the fact about this being pure. We ain't dealing with that. We speak English. As I said in the past, I can barely speak that. Okay? But that's what we speak. When you go to Yeshua chapter 28, I said this on the last second, didn't I? What did it say there? And he shall speak to this people, you understand, with the stammering lips and another tongue. What is he going to be speaking to? What is at the top of chapter 28? Who is it talking about? Elohim, is it not? Okay, and the 10 tribes were referred to as Elohim. They refer to Israel. They were referred to as Samaria. It says that, you know, because it's talking about Islam, Yazan. You understand? He's going to be speaking, you understand, one of his own, you know what I mean, the seed of death. He's going to be speaking to this people with stammering lips and another tongue. Well, we speak English, which is the preeminent language in the world today, is it not? Because the English-speaking people, you understand, the Illuminati Edomites, the British, you understand, don't they speak English? Primarily. Okay. Now, what's next? Okay, Yehuda, my wife, Keturah, had to go to the hospital yesterday before the Sabbath began at 8, be with her daughter after having her first child, and she got discharged at 5 today. We prayed about it, but she was sent by the doctor. Will you allow Yah to use you to help me with this situation? Brother, you know, I don't know when you say you ought to use me about the two of coming out on Sabbath to bring daughter and child home from hospital. Peace, brother. Again, that's for you and Keturah to turn toward your rules, pray to Yah, and pour out your soul to him. Yah is greatly merciful. You know, crap happens. Okay? You wasn't trying to have it happen like that. It happened like that. So you just pray to him and you know, offer up your supplication to the Most High. You know, just like I do, you know, I mess up or get caught in an adverse situation. Again, you know, you give it to the Most High. And if he, you know, puts a little whipping on you or a little affliction, you can take that, you can't handle. All right? But it was a situation that came about. Like I said, you turn to Jerusalem, you and your wife, y'all pray to the Most High and offer up the cares of your lips, Hosea 14th chapter. Okay, it says, is it right for a woman to pray to Yah when she is in the custom of women all the time of separation? Why not? Why not? Okay, why not? You know, I haven't seen anything in the book where a woman can't pray and she's separated. It's her time of the month. I haven't seen anything that negates her from praying. Now, quite naturally, you know, certain things she can't do, but I didn't see praying as one of them. So what's next? Could we put the food in a thermo right before the Sabbath and eat it the next day on the Shabbat Sabbath without breaking the Sabbath? Why not? If you put it in a thermo, it's already warm. Why not? You did it before the Sabbath started. Nothing wrong with that. Okay, what's next? Okay, Isaiah 9:13, Ephraim, as I saw Taz, is planning a pleasant place, but Ephraim shall bring forth his children to the mother. Correct. That's absolutely correct. That's what it says. What's next?
Can you drink alcohol in moderation?
Okay, can you drink alcohol in moderation, or should we not drink it at all? Well, when you say alcohol, wine is in the book, and we're going to drink wine, okay? Now, that's not mean we're supposed to be a wine-o, right? Again, we're supposed to, like you say, in moderation, and have some sense about it, and we're not supposed to drink the wine when it leaves its color in the cup, when it bites like an adder at the end, you know? Because that's too strong. So right there, that like is an understanding on that real strong drink, when it gets up in high proof, like 70, 80, 90 proof, 100 proof, we ain't supposed to fool with that. That's too strong. See? I remember not long ago, it's been about, I don't know, a couple years now, I was out, and so with my guy, we was listening to some jazz out, and so, I got a cognac, right, Remy Martin, but I had him put it in a one shot in this glass, like a 12-ounce glass, chucked with ice, and I just let it sit there until all that melted, you know what I mean? It, not all of it, but, most of it just melted, and it was weak then, and then I just sipped on it, and because I don't want to get inebriated. I ain't never like that, okay? Okay, and as Yada just heard, you might have heard that wine is one of our sustainers, like it says corn. Now, again, I when it says corn, is it the corn that we generally think of? Was that wheat or barley or one of these other grains that, we don't know? But I would think it's corn, because corn is one of the things I love. I love corn. But anyway, y'all straighten all that out, we get on. What's next? The breaches that is mentioned in Ezekiel chapter 4, 390 days for Israel, and the 40 days for you to explain, please. Well, again, he was told to lay on his left side 390 days each day for a year for the iniquity of the 10 tribes. And this, Ezekiel started prophesying. Yah came to him in the fifth year of his captivity. He went out in 597 with Coney, okay? It was taken up into Babylon. So the fifth year of his captivity is 592 BCE. Now, when you get to chapter 4, it very well could be like 590 BCE. Let's say arbitrarily it's 590 BCE, right? Chapter 4, Ezekiel. So now when you add 390 years to 590, you get 980 BCE. And when you go back to 980 BCE, David, that's about the time when David committed the adultery and the murder. And it could very well be when you go back to 2 Samuel chapter, 19, and you see, and I've talked about this not long ago, you see when Absalom had been killed and David was like, how come the people haven't said to bring me back to Jerusalem? And the 10 tribes, they like, well, we're going to bring David back. But they didn't, go get Yehuda to do it. They just were going to do it themselves. And when Yehuda got wind of it, they like beat the 10 tribes to the punch to bring David back. And then the 10 tribes confronted Yehuda, Benjamin, like, how come y'all didn't, come get us to bring David back? And it was some nasty words exchanged. And as it tells you that the words of Yehuda were more fierce than the 10 tribes' words. And so the son of Bichri, he said, we don't have any part in the son of Jesse, all Israel to their tent, the 10 tribes, right? And then you go like into chapter 20, 2 Samuel. And that's when the rebellion, another rebellion was arising the son of Bickery was killed. But we seeing an unraveling that begins there. Okay? But this all came about, okay, with the 10 tribes because of what David had done. Okay? So the 10 tribes started to go somewhat awry at that time. But like I said, that revolt had to be put down. That was right after the situation with Absalom. And it was, but we started to see an unraveling. And then we know what happened with Solomon, even though that was, you know, some years later, right? Over 40 years later. Because David died in 964 BCE, Solomon reigned 40 years, so now we're talking 924 BCE, and now Rehoboam comes up on the throne, and we know that's when Yah, because of what Solomon did, that's when Yah took the 10 tribes away from the house of David, right? And we know that they went off into idolatry shortly thereafter, you know what I mean, under Jeroboam, and they have not come back to this day. So you know, we're talking now what? We're talking almost 3,000 years from what we can see time-wise that the 10 tribes have gone away from Yah and been in idolatry. But nevertheless, the 390 years on to the 590 years, again, is 980. That's when I look at, you know, when Yah says the iniquity of the 10 tribes. And once he accomplished the 390 days on his left side for the iniquity of the 10 tribes, he was to turn over on his right side for 40 days for the iniquity of Yehuda and Benjamin. So you just add 40 years to 590 and you get 630. And when you go back to 630, that's during the time of Yosha, right? And we know that when Yosha came up on the throne, the first, what is it, like the first 10 years, he didn't know anything about Yah. Right? Until they found the book in his presence, and then he rent his clothes from the Most High, right? And he tried his best to get them in order, but, you know, Yah sent word to him to tell him, you know, it's too late for that. You know, the whipping's on its way, but I ain't going to let you live long enough to really see it. I'm going to take you off the scene since your heart was tender when you heard all these words that I had pronounced against Jerusalem and Yehuda. You understand? I ain't going to let you live long enough to see all this drama I'm going to bring on him. I'm going to take you off the scene. And that's, you know, he went out and met Pharaoh Necho when, you know, in a situation that had nothing to do with him. And Pharaoh Necho tried to get him, you know, King, the Pharaoh of Egypt tried to get him to turn aside, but he wouldn't, and that's when Yosha got killed. But Yah is basically saying that's when the iniquity of Yehuda and Benjamin, you know, Jerusalem had reached, and again, basically Yehuda, right, had reached its zenith, per se, because, you know, it had been talked about long before that, what Yah was going to do to Jerusalem in the book of Micah, also in Yeshaya. And Micah was contemporary with Yeshaya for a little bit, you know, not the whole, you know, not the whole time of Yeshaya, but for a part of that time, he was contemporary with Yeshaya. So, you know, also we see there, you didn't mention it, but I'll just touch on it. You see there in that same place, chapter 4. That Yah talks about when he brought this on Yehuda, you understand, when Ezekiel was prophesying about Yehuda, he was supposed to uncover his right arm, and that's in reference to Jerusalem. See, and that's why, you know, we know Jerusalem when you see the arm of Yah, that's what it's talking about. You know, like in the 51st, 52nd chapter, 48th chapter, Yeshaya. You know, it's in some other places too where it mentions the arm of Yah. It's talking about Jerusalem. It's not talking about all Israel. What's next? I hope that explained. If you still have a problem, you know, come on back with whatever. Okay. Okay, I understand the law of not wearing mixed linens, but are synthetic fabrics okay to wear? No. We're not supposed to wear synthetics. We're only supposed to wear materials that are going to allow our bodies to breathe. You know, the biggest eliminative organ on the body is the skin. That's why you got pores all over your body. And those pores have to, you know, they allow your body to breathe. That's why using deodorants with antiperspirants in it is not good, because they block the pores, don't allow, you know, your body to breathe under your arms. And that's not good. You know, that's why you're not supposed to use antiperspirants. So we're only supposed to use fabrics that allow your body to breathe, and that's cotton 100%, wool 100%, linen 100%, silk 100%, and that's it. Cotton, silk, wool, linen, that's it. You know, by actually, you know, leather, not pleather, right? 100% leather. You know, with the redness of the sheep or the cow, you know, the steer, the ox, even, we can wear moose, because we can eat moose. We can wear, buffalo, because we can eat buffalo, because all that's in the cattle. You know what I'm saying? What's next? Okay, the laws say that we cannot mix linens with wool, but you can mix linen with cotton and or silk. No, I haven't seen that. Oh, but can you? No, you can't. We're not supposed to wear diverse garments. You know, we're just like we're not supposed to eat diverse things. Like I was telling somebody the other day, and yesterday I saw it when I was in the store. They had a big old display with pluots. And for you out there that don't know what a pluot is, that's an apricot and a plum that's been spliced together. And they call it the pluot. See, but we're not supposed to eat that. Just like John Gold apples. You might have heard my mother. She said she never heard of pluots. I talked about the pluots way back. I became first a knowledgeable of those back in 95. Just like the John Gold apple, you shouldn't eat that, because that's a Jonathan apple and an apple, you know, a golden delicious apple that's been mixed. And that's where you get the John Gold. A golden delicious and a Jonathan that's been spliced together. Okay? We're not supposed to eat diverse. We're not supposed to wear diverse. We're not supposed to be diverse. That, remember, that's the strength of the fourth kingdom. Daniel chapter 7. Diversity. He has attacked everybody with diversity. Okay? Divide and conquer. And that's by any means necessary. That's what he is always trying to do. Divide the people, keep the people into these cliques, okay? He doesn't want us to come together unified, because that's strength. What's next?
They have out the tangerine and orange.
Okay, the tangerine and the orange mix, yeah, I don't doubt it. We under full-fledged attack. Full-fledged attack. They hitting us from every way possible, not only us but the people of the world, but definitely Israel. Like I said, they know where the light's going to come through. Why you think they attacked the room? When I was talking earlier about, you understand, Maya Amschel Bauer and how he changed his name to Rothschild after that red shield that he painted with the red cross and the white background, he painted it all red and hung it up over the goldsmith shop and surnamed himself Maya Amschel Rothschild. Red Shield, which takes you all the way back to the Knights Temple, okay? And again, you know, when the French king attacked them in 1306, they went underground. They popped up about, you know, 140 years later as the Rosicrucians. And when you look up Rosicrucians, what does it mean? Rosy or Red Cross. Okay? Red Cross. Same people, you know what I mean? They're descendants. Same mindset, but they just changed it a little bit. You follow what I'm saying? That's Esau. Just like I talked about the Red Cross earlier. I ain't heard anything about the Red Cross in a while, okay? But I know they was over in Africa inoculating people for years, and here in America and other places. That's what they do. See? Now, just like the brother was that Zion train brought up about, what? Chikunga, or whatever that was, virus. I mean, they got all kind of viruses. They've been coming out with all kind of viruses since what? The last what? Over 40 years, almost the last 45 years, 44 years. I remember they was coming out with they was talking about the Hong Kong flu back about 1970-71.
Swine flu.
Yeah, but matter of fact, I think they even come out with the swine flu first.
Yeah,
they were talking about the swine flu back then. Then later on, they come out with the Hong Kong flu. See? And then, you know, all other kind of viruses, the Ebola virus. Now you got this little Chihonga or whatever virus. I mean, they come out with something all the time. But see, like I said, you know, in this session, the people over there in the continent, in Africa, they not letting them inoculate them because they know that they are under attack. So now they put the spin on it, they being Illuminati Edomite, they put the spin through the media saying the reason why these viruses and whatnot are springing up over there because they won't allow them to vaccinate. Now, that's how they put the spin on it. See? But again, we're supposed to go back to herbs, okay? Herbs, like I just talked about, you know, in the session, not coffee. What was this, the last session? Not coffee, right? You know, not these teas, you know, these teas that just, you know, taste good. We're supposed to go into teas that's herbal teas. You follow what I'm saying? Just like what you see there in Ezekiel chapter 47. When Yah brings all of them, those trees, those orchards, on either side, you know, going to be on both sides of the healing waters that turns into a river. We eat the fruit of these trees, but we take the leaves for medicine, like peach tree leaves. They expel worms. You follow me? And the other different herbs, they do different things. When we boil some water, we put them herbs in there and steep them. See, and those trees that's going to be growing over in the land, those leaves going to be powerful. Okay? They're going to be powerful. You understand what I'm saying? And when we steep different ones for different things, that's how you think we're going to get cleansed. You know, quite naturally, the healing water, but it's a combination of all of that. Eating pure foods, drinking these teas, that's going to purge our system of all kind of contaminants and toxins and waste, chemtrails, fluoridated water coming out the taps. All this fracking crap that they shooting under the ground into the aquifers that's coming out in your water, your drinking water, where you can light the water, put a match to it, and flames shoot out. I know y'all seen Gasland 1, Gasland 2. If you haven't, Google that and bring that up and watch that. Gasland 1 and Gasland 2. I mean, it's a mess. It's a mess. And that's why, again, this is the time. Because if not, just like I read this article in this session, you understand? The Paul Craig Rogers article. You follow me? Now, this is an astute man, knowledgeable, okay? He's been in government. He was with the Reagan administration back there 30-something years ago, okay, or 30 years ago. You understand what I'm saying? This is an astute man. You go to his site, he's talking some real stuff. That's why I read the article. The article is dead on point. Okay, go back and listen to it again and again and again. I know your Dina's going to play it, all right? And listen to what this man says. He's not trying to, he's not uplifting himself. He tell you that, you understand, these chemtrails and things of that nature, that's not even his field, and he don't pretend to expound on them like it is his field, but he can see how detrimental this stuff is. See, his field is economics and government, and he talks about that. And what did he say? If nothing, if something ain't done, you understand, profoundly, in the very, very near future, the life as we know it on Earth is going to become extinct. Now, I mean, we seeing Yah's creation collapsing all around us. The bats is dying off in droves. And we've been talking about that for some years now. The bees is dying off in droves. The butterflies is dying off in droves. You got other species that's on the brink of extinction. You understand? And when one of these things goes out ecologically, it causes a domino effect. And all of it has a ramification on the human species. You got a hole in the ozone. Okay? They don't even talk about that anymore. Think about it. You don't hear anything about that anymore. And they're out there spraying chemtrails every day. Barium, strontium, and aluminum. That's why these fires are so prolific like they are. Think about it. You know, think about why you think we read these newspaper articles every session. We've got newspaper articles. Why you think we in there? Don't we take you over into prophecy and read prophecy generally? You understand? You understand? In general, what we pinpointed? You understand? That's why we bring these things up about the tornadoes and the typhoons and the hurricanes. Huh? Babylon sinking. They tell you the water's rising, so that means it's sinking, right? I mean, you know, think about it. This is all the book. This is all prophetic. That's why we read these articles about economic collapse, environmental collapse, ecological collapse. This is all prophetic. The sword on the chariots, the cars, the SUVs, the motorcycles. Recalls in the millions. But they can put a spaceship up there, but they can't make a car right. Think about that. What's next? What can you tell us about the blood moon? I can't tell you nothing about it. I'm waiting to see it. You understand what I'm saying? I mean, I'm waiting to see it. And again, you know, the moon turning actually blood could very well be, again, from all the chemicals and crap in the air and the hole in the ozone. But I haven't seen the blood yet. I've seen an orangey, kind of orangey red, but I ain't seen the blood. Blood is blood, okay? But it's going to be that. It's on its way to being that. What's next? No coffee. I don't touch it. Now, I got out of that long time ago, just like I got out of a lot of other crap. What's next? Coffee is adverse to the system, period. Okay? I'm for life, not for death. What's next? According to historical records, Ahasuerus, 485, 465, is the son of Darius the Great. Okay, well, again, we know, that's correct. And again, Xerxes Ahasuerus was assassinated. I wonder who assassinated him. Okay, because he got killed, 7-8 years after the situation in the book of Esther. Because that all happened like 473. 473, 472 BCE. So 7-8 years later, he got assassinated. I wonder who was behind that. Okay? And then Darius the Great, he fought to him again. Like I said, they give you a 532, Zion Train 2. It's 521, he had on the throne. I've seen them both, so take your pick. But, you know, it was in the second year of his reign. You understand, when Zerubbabel and them, you know, through the process of Haggai and Zechariah, they got stirred up and they went to start building on the temple without any permission. They went by way from Cyrus, and then they got confronted by Esau, you know, whatever Edomites and Ishmaelites in the land. That's when they said, we better write a letter. That's when you go to Ezra chapter 5 and chapter 6 and read what, you know, how Darius the Great responded. Okay? But in Daniel 9:1, it says Darius is the son of Ahasuerus. But again, that's a different Darius Zion train. That's Darius Ahasuerus. Darius the Median, who was made king over the realm of the Chaldeans by Cyrus the Great. Darius the Median being what? 3 score and 2 years old. He was one of Cyrus the Great's generals. He was a Median, not a Persian. Darius the Great was Persian. That's why, you understand, in chapter 6, Daniel, it tells you he was over, or he had 120 princes. He was over 120 provinces. He was the great king. Darius the Mede, or Darius Ahasuerus, the son of Ahasuerus, right? Darius the Median, the son of Ahasuerus, he was just over the realm of the Chaldeans. He was one of those 120 princes under Cyrus the Great King. Because again, you know, it was the Medes and the Persians, and basically the Persians under Cyrus that set up satrapy, S-A-T-R-A-P-Y. That still goes on today here in America. That's why you got these different states, and they got a governor or a king that's over a specific territory, you understand, state, but they all are supposed to be answerable to Barack Obama, who's supposed to be the great king. But we know that's just, you know, we know that's just for show, right? It's not really actually, you know, he doesn't have no power. We know that, right? None of them do, really. They all taking orders from the Illuminati, Edomite, the House of Rothschild. What's next? If I'm not mistaken, Ahasuerus was a name or title given to more than one Persian king. And Xerxes was one of them that was called Ahasuerus. Correct. What's next? That's it? Okay. Well, if that's it, I'll give you, you know, a minute or two, but, you know, someone might come up with something. Okay, I see this. Is a woman supposed to wear a head covering even while not in prayer? A woman, I've never seen where a woman is supposed to wear a head covering. You know, now, if you've seen that somewhere, Rebat Yisrael, put that up, so show me or show us where that is, because I've never seen that. I've spoken on that before in regards to when people are in mourning, they cover their head. Priests, they have their head covered, the ones that had the anointing oil poured on, you know, like the high priest, and maybe the other priests too, right? But I've never seen where a woman's supposed to have her head covered. I'm pretty sure that's some of Judaism, okay? That people are moving over into Yah, trying to move over into Yahism, okay? And again, like Yeshua just put up, y'all know him as Abadiah per se, but Yeshua, that is tradition, and we know about tradition. Tradition is word of mouth. And all of you that heard me today, right, if you were to tell somebody tonight or tomorrow or the next day or the next day what I said today, you're not going to have it verbatim. That's tradition. Something is going to change. Okay? The only way it can be actual verbatim, when you read in the book, and I know all of you that basically, and again, Yeshaya, tradition basically means oral. Okay, you can check it out. You know, if you say tradition, that's what it's talking about. It's come down orally. Okay? But when you read in the book, you're going to see what? Our forefathers had a scribe and they had a recorder. It was always one of each, a scribe and a recorder, okay? And I'm pretty sure, I bet you anything, they checked their notes against one another at the end of whatever sessions or whatever. You see what I'm saying? They wrote it down, you see? They wrote it down. And see, when you write it down, then, it, you know, unless somebody like Esau goes and specifically tries to change it, okay, if they, you know, like the Edomites, Illuminati Edomite did, that's in stone because it's written down. And it's not going to change unless somebody actually goes in there and fools with it. Okay? Okay, I never found it in scripture, but a lot of women are telling me, yeah, it's out of modesty, and they say it's, it says it in the book, but I never have found it. Well, Rebot, when one of those sisters who you talk to that you know, or two or three or four of them, you talk to them. Next time you talk to them or you call them, you ask them to show you where that is. That's what I do. When people come up with something that, you know, I haven't seen or don't recall seeing, That's pretty, like I said on this session, you know, about the person that came at me with Yah Loves the Wicked. I said, well, where is that? I don't recall seeing that. And I got to respond, you know what I'm talking about. You know where it is. I said, no, I don't know where that is. You understand? Then they came back later, like the next day, and telling me, you know, like I said, I think it's 33:11, Ezekiel, you know, Yah takes no pleasure in the death of the wicked. Yeah, but that's not saying he loves the wicked. He takes no pleasure in their death, but he doesn't love the wicked. He wants the wicked to acknowledge their wickedness and turn. Okay, like I said, you know, read Ezekiel 18 chapter. Matter of fact, the same person came back in that same thing, when the message they left, Ezekiel 18 chapter, which again, that's self-explanatory. You understand?
When they read and stuff,
you know, you're supposed to, you know, when you find out what's right, see, and you can read it, you know, you can, when you read it and see it, you understand? Then you're supposed to acknowledge it and turn away from your wickedness, let that crap go, okay? And then embrace righteousness, and you'll live for your righteousness' sake. And your wickedness that you were doing, that you didn't know was wicked, won't be mentioned to you. Now, that's Ezekiel 18 chapter, okay? But it also says in that 18th chapter that the righteous person can know, you know, can know what's right? Turn their righteousness and turn to iniquity and wickedness, and all their righteousness will be forgotten, and they will die in their iniquity. So right there, from that, how can Yah love the wicked? See? Now Yah, again, when wickedness is done from a lack of knowledge and ignorance, Yah will give you a chance to search out righteousness. If you pulling wickedness and vanity with a cart rope and refuse to seek righteousness, then you will remain in your wickedness and you'll die for your iniquity. Huh? I mean, you know, just go to Jeremiah chapter 17, right? Huh? You know, you'll die in your wickedness. Yah tries the heart, the reins thereof, to give everyone according to their desire. It doesn't say that there. I'm saying that. Your ways. Because your desire precedes your ways. Now that's how I understand it. And again, we gotta remember the book has been translated by Eve. So he's got some stuff, you know, out of whack here and there. Okay? But your desire comes before your ways. You got to desire something before you can pursue it. Is that not right? You know, not quite naturally. We get geared. We're raised in certain things, you know, and we develop a taste for it or not. But at some point, right, when y'all's bringing that whipping on you, for your ways, if you got, you're going to stop and consider, huh? Right? When prosperity comes, be joyful. When adversity comes, consider. I mean, you keep getting your, we've been saying about our brothers and sisters, so-called Palestinians. How long they going to keep praying 5 times a day, calling on Allah, and getting blown out the box, getting their houses blown up, getting bombs dropped on them, you understand, under open air prison lockdown in the Gaza, being totally ostracized over the last 66 years, since 1948. And that's just our brothers and sisters in the land, you know, what's being called Israel, because it ain't totally Israel, you know, that's just part of it, you understand? That ain't talking about our other brothers and sisters, you know, in other lands, whether they so-called Palestinians or so-called African Americans or so-called Brazilians, Jamaicans, Haitians, Dominicans, huh? Belizeans or so on and so forth. Because wherever Israel is, Pakistan, you understand, Iraq, Syria, Iran, Russia, wherever Israel is, they catch a nail. Unless they turn to Yah. Yah has started to restore comforts unto them. Because they've embraced the law with all their heart and all their soul. Now, as I said not long ago, in what, last session, these ones who are these, however many movements it is, that have formed this Yah will gather us, They run around like chickens with their heads cut off, and they went and joined Better World. I mean, you know, jumped out of the frying pan in the proverbial fire. Okay? And why are they doing that? Because they want to share resources. Because it's getting harder every day. Prices is going up. Huh? Economics is drying up. Things is getting harder. So they want to come together regardless to what their persuasion is. And they think they're going to, you know, make it better for themselves if they join forces. Like I said, like Ahab. When he called on Jehoshaphat and Jehoshaphat went to him, almost got himself killed. So again, they're making, you know, wrong decisions. Like those of you out there who have gone to Mahalia's site, the Diary of a Revolutionary, she was with them, now she done left them. She done totally divorced herself from them because she saw it's a bunch of gang. She hasn't come out and said what she actually saw and what she's witnessed that made her totally, you understand, move away from this Yahweh Gathers, Better World, all of it. She done moved away from all of that. She was embracing it here the other month. Now she done totally divorced herself from it because she saw something and she relayed that you know, it's not right. But she hasn't actually come out and said what it is. See? But she saw it was some scammerama ding dong, more likely than not. Because they always trying to come up with a scheme to get money. And that's what we've been watching ICL for years. And again, you know, I'm just calling it like it is. All right? ICL always trying to come up with some kind of scheme to make money. See? But he ain't really serving the Most High. And I've said this before. And that's the reality of it. That's why they got him dangling on a string right now, waiting to see what's going to happen. Is he going to do some time in jail? Or are they going to give him home confinement, probation, or what? See? And knowing the Illuminated Edomite, he probably, if he hadn't totally or coerced ICL already, that might be what he's trying to do now, to see how well he can get ICL, you know, up under his wing and on the payment line. Now, if ICL gets totally cut loose, more than likely, he's totally turned to the Illuminati Edomite and given himself up total, knowingly. Knowingly. You understand? If they send him away, do some time, then he held to his guns. He didn't totally, you know, rank himself and go over totally to the enemy. He was already with the enemy because he ain't with Yah. It ain't no equivocation. There is no straddling the fence. You either with Yah or you with the enemy. Simple as that. No matter what you might think. Okay? It's the same thing with these drug boys out here. You know, that we got here in the community and we got around the world and different places all through America and all in other places of the world. They doing all they, you understand, all they understand. A lot of them don't want to do it, but they ain't got no other way where they see that they can make a living. I hate to see it, but like I said in the past, you know, I've had conversations with just a few around here when the opportunity presents itself, we get to a little something. Any understanding, so it's only somebody they can siphon off, and it's very little. And again, when it comes down to whether they're gonna eat tonight, whether they're gonna pay the light bill and the gas bill and the rent, they're gonna sell them drugs. Simple as that, and I understand that. You know, it takes a lot of fortitude. You follow what I'm saying? But to let that go when that's your own source of income. And again, you got to have to see when I did that just 10 years ago, it wasn't the ways of the heathen. I already knew about the Most High. You follow me? I knew. I didn't know his name, but I knew about the Creator and had been knowing about him for a decade. You follow me? So I had a certain amount of strength that I could draw from, which is our strength, our power, he who creates. But I didn't know his name then. I didn't even know, you know, his name or what it meant. But I still depended and trusted in the Creator. The Most High. just like I did from the get-go when I prayed to the Most High. I didn't know which way to pray, but I prayed and said, show me the truth. I know you exist. Now I want to know the truth. So show me what the truth is. And he proceeded to do that. You follow me? But I was blocking myself because I wasn't letting go totally of the ways of the heathen. And it took me almost 10 years to realize that. Like I said, I've talked about it just here the last session, right? When the two-legged jackass, y'all came through the mouth of the two-legged jackass, and when he said what he said to me, I understood that. And I could see myself plain. And that's when I said I got to let go of the ways of the heathen total and totally to depend on the Most High. But I had a certain amount of strength, a certain amount of foundation that I had already acquired. You see what I'm saying? So I put my faith in the Most High and leaped off totally on him. And as I said in the past, he didn't let me splatter all over the concrete. He caught me in a net right before I hit the ground and kept me, you know, viable. And then I rededicated myself. But it didn't happen overnight. I went years, okay? I went about 7 years before he started allowing me to really kind of, you know, make some money again and start, you know, working my way, you know, up out of that situation. But at the same time, I understood it, but it was some bleak moments during those almost 7 years. It was some bleak moments. I kid you not. Like I said, you know, in this session that just aired, you know, about the emotion part. It's easier said than done, but that's what we've got to do. We've got to put emotions to the side and lift the bar to this highest level of understanding. That's the only way we're going to make it. And again, you know, those who hear this message in the room now, those who will hear it in the future, you follow what I'm saying? Some will be able to do it like I said a little while ago, okay? Out of the many Israel that exist today, we only got a small group right now that has awakened to the fact that they Israel compared to the whole. Out of that small group that has awakened to the fact they Israel, those of you out there know yourself that it's many that's what? Out of that small group that is awakened to the fact they Israel, they're compromised. They in Judaism. They in Christianity. But they know they Israel. You follow what I'm saying? All right, now you take that ones that are left who are totally about the Most High. You got many, just like some in the room today, still not spelling the name of the Most High correctly in English. They come up with this I-H-U-H stuff. They come up with Y-A-H. You follow what I'm saying? We've told them about it before, but they hard-headed. They want to argue. They want to fuss. They want to tussle. See? Because we're dealing with what? A rebellious house. A rebellious people. We are the descendants thereof. See? So how much more, huh, these ones who don't even know they Israel yet, who have no foundation, who are still being whipped. See? Because you got different ones of these boys out here who in the drug world, you understand? And they working for the man. I'll say most of them understand that. I would say most of them don't understand that. And I might be, you know, giving them the benefit of the doubt there, but I would say most of them don't understand that they're really working for the man selling drugs to their people or whomever they're selling drugs to. But some of them absolutely know they're working for the man. And I mean literally know they're working for the man. And they don't care. You follow? They don't care. All they want is them dollars. See? Now you got Israelites, again, who've awakened to the fact they Israel, and when they compromise themselves into Judaism, Christianity, or their own isms, they working for the man too. When they come up with this garbage about, you understand, the men don't have to be circumcised. Yah didn't have any Sabbath day. He didn't have no peace day. Ain't no such thing as a 7-day Sabbath. I mean, when they do anything that's out of realm of this book, that's laid out here in this book, Genesis through Malachi, this book of remembrance, that's all over the world, in over 2,000 languages, King James Authorized Version, they're working for the oppressor. They're working for the heathen. And that's how I look at that. And that's been my thing. That's what I've said here the other year. You know, it's been a while. A couple of times I said it back in 2012 since we've been doing Pathos. I'm pretty sure I said it on one of the two of the shows we did with Mark Sims. I'm a revolutionary. I want to attack these people who are doing these nasty, dastardly things to not only Israel, but the people of the world. Abusing them, misusing them, who destroying the world. Well, I know that's the Illuminati Edomite. Now, I know these monarchies been complicit with. Now it's their chance, these monarchies, to turn the leaf. Huh? It's their chance. The door is open now for them to come to the Most High and to start washing their slate clean. Now, we got to wait and see which one of them going to grab it. We know they're coming because y'all done said they're coming. Now, it might not be Liz and Philip, because they too set in their ways, done too much nasty stuff. You follow what I'm saying? And it might not even be Charles, okay? Or those who's on the same level with him in Spain or Denmark or Sweden or the Netherlands or Belgium. You follow what I'm saying? Norway. But it might be their sons. It might be William. See? But we know they're coming because y'all said they're coming. Like I said, the battle's already won. It just remains to see who's going to fit these positions. Who's going to turn to y'all and serve it? Who has enough understanding that they want to keep their seed on this earth, that they want better not only for themselves but for their children? And if they don't have any children, that they want children and they want to see set up their line in the kingdom of Yah, where that line will be here forever. That they want to bring an end to all this nasty, dastardly stuff that's being perpetrated on the inhabitants of the earth, because it's coming to an end. They're not going to stop that. Like I said in the past, Yah's kingdom is being set up as we speak. Yah's kingdom is going to develop this whole earth. Nothing's going to stop that. That's just what side you want to be on. And while the door is open, I would advise any and everybody, while that door is open, to take heed and come on through that door while you got a chance. Because I can tell you, the door ain't going to always stay open. That's in the book too. When Yah says, come unto me while I am near, while I can be found. So what is he telling you? It's going to come a time when he ain't going to be near and he can't be found. The door going to be shut. And if you're on the other side over there in the darkness, you're going to be in the darkness forever, and then that'll be the end of you and your wife. More likely than not. Unless you got some siblings or some children, you understand, that made the decision to come on over. But again, like I said on this session, I ain't waiting for nobody. I can't tell nobody to wait. Now, you got some out there breathing, you know, like y'all said, the Saul. I mean, the Samuel, about Saul. How long you know, what was that, 1 Samuel 16? How long you grieve about Saul, seeing as I rejected him? Okay? And again, you know, for this person who I talked about here in Chicago, I remember I was up 2 o'clock in the morning listening to some of his crap, right? And one of his arguments is that, you understand, Yah, who's supposed to be all-knowing, because he said this whole thing is mythological. He picked Saul, knowing that Saul wasn't going to do right. And it's in the book. Well, again, he doesn't understand, again, that the book has been translated by the Illuminati Edomite, right? So, you know, it's going to be not quite exactly as it was initially. But he also fails to understand. And those of you who hear this today or whenever you hear, you go check it out. Yah gave the people what they wanted. Saul wasn't who he wanted. As I've said in the past, when you go back to 1 Samuel, chapter 2, what did Yah say in regards, what did he say through Samuel to Eli? He said, it's going to come a time where there's a faithful priest that's going to walk before mine anointed forever. So y'all already talking about how he was going to raise up a governor. And this ain't the first time, because he first mentioned it in Genesis chapter 49 in regards to Yahuda, when he talked about Scepter, the part from the field between the field of Yahuda,
when Shiloh came. Okay? Because when Shiloh came, Yahushua of the tribe of Ephraim was governor. There wasn't anybody of Yahuda that was governor when Shiloh came. The scepter didn't return back into Yahuda or come into Yahuda until when? Until Dawid, David. And remember, you understand what Moses asked Yah when he came up out of Egypt. What did he say? What did he ask Yah? He said, what tribe is going to be first? What did Yah tell him? Yahuda. Okay? So, you know, like I said, you understand? It was Yah that gave the people what they asked for. That's why he told Samuel, he said, show them the matter of the king that they want. And Samuel did that. And then what did they say? We don't care. We still want to be like the other nations. We still want this kind of king. So Yah picked Saul and gave it to him. You know, where is it in the book? I know one of y'all know it off the top of your head. It escapes me now. What did y'all say? I gave you a king in my anger, and I took him away in my wrath. He gave them what they asked for. See? He gave them what they asked for. But what did he tell Samuel? When Saul kept messing up, when he messed up that second time in regards to the Amalekites, what did y'all say to Samuel in 1 Samuel 16? How long you going to grieve about Saul? Forget about him. You understand? Get the anointing on him and go to Bethlehem Ephratah. What? Of Yahuda. Bethlehem Ephratah is just the town. In Yahuda. He said, go there. I got a man there that's what? After my own heart. He gonna do just what I want. You know? Then this one here in Chicago, he made a point about that. He said, Samuel was afraid to go. He said, how can I go? Saul here, about to kill me. He said, then y'all told him how to be deceitful. Okay? But again, what did y'all tell Samuel? He said, just tell him you're going to do a sacrifice in Bethlehem, Ephrathah. Well, he did that too. In other words, just don't tell him everything. And then what does y'all say how he deals with the unsavory, with the wicked? Doesn't he say he deals with the wicked in unsavoriness just the same way they are? He repays them, gives them same thing with that. I mean, isn't that what you reap what you sow? Y'all deals with you the same way you are. Saul was wicked and unsavory, so y'all dealt with him the same way. And then in the end, as it says, he repaid him to his face. Literally, because when Saul disguised himself and went into the soothsayer, as I've talked about in the past, right? He went in there disguised. She didn't know it was Saul. And she said, what you want? She said, when he told her, she said, well, you know, Saul done banned that. Like I said before, Saul did some of the stuff y'all wanted him to do. He just didn't do it all. He was picking and choosing. And when she tried to, you know, tell him, no, you know, I can't, he said, no, ain't nothing going to happen to you. She don't know it's Saul. So then she said, okay, when she agreed to do it, she knows she running game, right? She was going to go through her little hocus pocus, right? But Yah really brought up Samuel. And when Samuel came up and she could see him, it scared her. She hollered, ah! See? And then Yah told her, you understand, Saul through her, you're going to be with me by this time tomorrow. What did Saul do? He repaired and do his thing. He fell out. You understand? He fell out on the ground. Because he told him, you're going to be dead by this time tomorrow. All your witness. See, everybody gets what they got coming. You can only put yourself in a position to be saved by Yah, by obeying his laws, statutes, ordinances, judgments, commandments, and precepts. It's your decision to make. Each and every one of us have to make that decision. Now, you can't take nobody with you. You can only get yourself there. Decision is yours. That is.
One thing before about this head covering. So
well, again, I, you know.
Somebody's asking about for men, about men covering their heads.
Only the priests, the Levites, cover their heads, and the high priest for certain, because he's had the anointing oil poured on him, and or going to have it, and possibly, you know. Even though I haven't seen it, but you know, it says that the seed of David is going to be like a priest on the throne, because he's not a, you know, he ain't carrying spear and sword, and, you know, he's Prince of Peace, and so he'll be like a priest on the throne. Because he's minister. He's a minister for the Most High. And, you know, he has his head covered most of the time when he's representing the Most High, all the time, per se, or when he's out. You know. So, and, you know, that I just wait. Anyway. So, read, study, pray, and do. Stay focused, okay? It's always our pleasure here. God Writes is here, and those of us who are, you know, Yah Righteousness, all of you out there that, you know, are attached to Yah Righteousness, read, study, pray, and do. Stay focused, stay committed. Read, okay? Read. All right? You've got to read the book. You've got to read the story, Genesis through Malachi. Okay? There's going to be some things that you're not going to understand right off. I can't make you understand. Yeshaya can't make you understand. Yeremia can't make you understand. Yadina can't make you understand. No, anybody else. It's only Yah. And when you do the things that's needed for Yah, you know, to give you that illumination in whatever area, he will give it to you when he sees you are ready for it. Okay? But read, study, pray, and do. Embrace Yah's laws. Let go of the way of the heathen. Okay? So, for Yah Righteousness, Jerusalem, and the Holy See, Yah bless. Peace.